standby, everyone. For some reason, the map just fell apart, so stand by, everyone. Sorry about this. Day 23. There we go. All right, so welcome to the stream, everyone. I am the Enforcer. Sorry for that little glitch. For some reason, it decided to just shut off my Google, so that was weird. But anyways, today we're going to be talking about the day 23 of the War of Ukraine. The Ukrainians have pushed the Russians back once again today. We have a lot of big news to cover, and so we're going to go over the schedule right away. The first thing first, we'll be covering, of course, this northern theater today. This will be incredibly short. We didn't get a lot of news out of the Chernihiv nor Kyiv area, so we're going to move straight on and answer the questions in between. We'll then cover the Eastern Front. We'll stop and take a break for more questions in between the Eastern Front and the Southern Front. Then we'll cover the Southern Front, move on to the rest of the country, the western area of the country in particular, and then we'll cover a little bit of news that we've gotten from inside of Russia today. So far, there wasn't enough news internationally to report today, so that's why we only have one international news subject. So, moving on from that, we're going to start covering what has happened in Kyiv today. So, first things first, we can see that apparently the counteroffensive from the Ukrainians is doing so well that the Russians are now preparing static positions to try and hold the area that they currently have. You can see the dug-in positions of these tanks here. Now, this says a lot. Because if the Russians viewed this counteroffensive as being weak, and if the Ukrainian counteroffensive was weak, then we wouldn't see them doing this, most likely. They would just simply repel it and then do a counterattack to that counteroffensive and just start pushing them back even further. But apparently the Ukrainians are making such great deals of ground and progress that the Russians are now having to dig in static positions like we see here along this tree line. So that's starting to suggest that the Russians may be running into some serious issues in terms of planning and the actual Ukrainian resistance. If there isn't any more solid kind of proof that the Ukrainians are putting up a good fight, it would be this right here that the Russians are having to actually dig in. So there's not really much to cover beyond that. We can just see that they dug static positions, and we can generally assume that that means things are not going well for them. So we're going to move on to the next bit of news that we've gotten, and we can see that they're using World War II-like tactics on the outskirts of Kyiv. Let me show you this real quick. As we can see, there's another MRE down there. It looks like they also had, like, a little, like, can of, like, meat, you know, like cat food. But in Russia, that's kind of like a normal way to store food, especially meat. It's like in a cat food kind of little container. But we can just see foxhole after foxhole after foxhole on the side of this road. Pretty interesting stuff, really. And so now the video is going on a loop, but you can just simply see that they had dug foxholes in the ground near that road, and that was fairly interesting and very weird that they're using those kinds of tactics today, because the last time we saw those tactics being used in mass, you know, it was kind of like during World War II, and now we can see them making a resurgence, at least in the Russian army, because things are just going that badly for them that they're actually starting to do things that desperate. And so now we're going to move on to our last bit of news in Kyiv, and then I'm going to talk about the general situation around the city, and that's that we've seen more damage in Kyiv. I'm going to show all these pictures real quick. There's just three of them, but we can see it appears this apartment block has been entirely leveled. In fact, well, not really leveled, but practically destroyed to the point they'll have to demolish it afterwards. You can actually see that everyone's furniture is still where it would be normally. It's just that the wall's gone, so it's almost like it's a cutaway picture of what an inside of a Ukrainian apartment building would look like. Very interesting. We can also see here that this van, what appears to be a van, has been ripped apart by gunfire, and there's a little Ukrainian flag in the doorway. I don't really know the story behind why it got shot up and why it had a Ukrainian flag, but nonetheless, it's a damaged van. Don't really know if there are any civilian casualties as well. And finally, This looks like it may be the other side of that apartment that we just saw. It had the entire side wall collapse, and we can see that the damage didn't stop there, and it appears that most of the balconies and the outside of the building has suffered some damage in other areas as well. So, very unfortunate stuff. Once again, it's kind of just run-of-the-mill damage that we see all over because the Russians just keep on bombarding everything. I know I say that every night, but it's just crazy that they're bombarding everything to the point that damage to this degree is just considered a normal thing in Ukraine now. So let's talk about this counterattack a little bit, because I know I don't really talk in depth about my opinion. I like to report facts, but I think we've gotten enough facts over the past few days to show some trends about this counterattack that's showing things that tie into what we've been talking about for weeks. So the first thing I like to say is that the Russian logistics must have fallen apart. There is no such thing now as the Russians waiting to attack, just push into Kyiv and end this thing, because now they're having to dig in and defend the land that they've taken. So that tells you that they're not in a position to easily swipe away this Ukrainian counterattack and then just go, ha ha, you know, we were hiding like 1,000 units in the woods and just roll them into Kyiv and take the place over. They don't have that ability, or otherwise they wouldn't be doing what they're doing. They would have already rolled this stuff out, wiped out this counterattack, wiped out most of the Ukrainian forces, and then just rolled into Kyiv. And we're not seeing that. We're not seeing them do that kind of thing. And so I'm assuming, based off of all the things that we've had so far, the lack of logistics, now we're seeing this, the Russians are in a very bad position. This is also probably why we're seeing all those Russians, the generals and such, getting removed in Moscow, and we're seeing so many of them get killed, is because everything is just being run so poorly that even generals aren't safe from the backlash from their own government or from sniper fire or fire from really anything in the Ukrainian arsenal that would kill them. And so things just aren't going well, and I think we're going to see this front line around the western side of Kyiv change even more over the coming days, because it doesn't look like the Russians are planning on having an easy time breaking this counteroffensive that they're currently finding themselves in. So we're going to move on up to the area of Chernihiv. Unfortunately, nothing has fortunately, actually, I guess you could say, nothing has happened up here today. We haven't gotten any news or video reports out of the area of Chernihiv. This may suggest a lull in fighting. I believe that's been the case, because every time we see anything from Chernihiv, it's mostly just destroyed buildings, artillery barrages, and rocket attacks. So I believe that the Russian offensive near Chernihiv has almost entirely stalled, and we're not going to see much in the meantime or soon from the Russians, because they just lack the ability to push offensives in so many areas, and that will be one of the areas that they've decided to not push anymore. So, that being said, we've actually knocked out this whole entire northern front in just like 10 minutes, which is really crazy. This is actually the shortest amount of time that we've covered the northern front end. There was just nothing really that happened today, at least in terms of film. And that may be another good thing, because we know that the Ukrainians aren't really as easy to give out footage of their own soldiers as Russia is to get footage of theirs and then send it out, either by Ukrainian civilians filming them and then letting the world know where they are, or the Russians filming them for propaganda purposes. And so what this may suggest is that the Russians have nothing good to show out of this area, and the Ukrainians or Ukrainian citizens cannot film because they're in the middle of a active war zone that's being moved backwards, and the Ukrainians aren't uploading videos for us to see what's happening. So that may actually be a good sign that there's no footage coming out, to the fact that the Ukrainians may be advancing, and that's why there's a lack of footage, if you see what I'm saying there. I'm sorry if I kind of like butchered my explanation there. But anyways, we've covered all of the northern front, and so we're about to move on to the location unknowns, the Sumy area, and Kharkiv on the eastern front. And so before I do that, we're going to take some questions from the chat. And so what do we got, Matthew?
All right, so first up tonight, we have a donation of 200 Filipino pesos from Eric Bloom. Eric, we do appreciate your support very much. Next up, we have a $5 donation from Jay Rillo. He asks, are you familiar with Gonzalo Lira? He lives in Kharkiv and does regular videos on the war. He also says the shelling gets worse and Russia is winning.
I have not actually seen him, and I had never really heard of him. But I mean, like, then again, you know, how does he know the Russians are winning? Because we don't have any video evidence that they're encircling Kharkiv, and we've seen, and you know, every single Western defense ministry or department has said that the Russian advance has stalled. And according to satellite footage and videos that, like we've seen today north of Kharkiv, where the Russians are having to prepare static defenses, that is not the signs of a winning army. That's the signs of a losing army, or an army that's close to losing everything that they've gained so far. That's just kind of common sense to me. But I mean, you know, of course, people are subject to their own opinions. Maybe he's just in Kharkiv and he's seeing the city get shelled every day, and so he's thinking that they're losing. But if he's looking at the actual situation that's been unfolding for days, like the massive amount of ground that's been made near Mykolaiv and the counter offensive making great ground up here in near Kyiv as well, I think that would be a little different to him. I actually have not run into any Ukrainians that have had family inside of Ukraine, because we actually do have a few that are active in the server, and I talk to them, that say that the Ukrainians are actively losing. In fact, they say that the city of Mariupol is being held fairly well, rather than the fact that they've run out of supplies, pretty much. So I don't really know where that guy is coming from, and I haven't heard of him either, but I thank you very much for the support and the question. I'll try and look into him and see what he's saying, because maybe he does have some validity to what he's saying, maybe, but I'll have to go check it out to see nonetheless. But I thank you very much for the support, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, so next up, we have a question from James Morris for $15 A. I'm not sure exactly what currency that is, but thank you very much for the donation. He asks, there are reports of former foreign legioners complaining of terrible conditions, no training, overwhelming Russian firepower, multi-year contracts, and no air support. What are your thoughts? Thanks.
I have seen one of them, and it was some guy, and I mean, you know, it kind of seemed weird to me about this one guy who posted this video that I watched. And I don't mean to discredit everything that's kind of like putting Ukraine in a negative light, but it didn't really make any sense to me, because we've seen pictures from the front lines of the Foreign Legion doing incredibly well in multiple different areas that it's been sent to. And then we got this guy, and he looks like I don't really know how to explain it, but he doesn't really look like he's had any military experience, if you know what I'm saying. It kind of looks like someone who just went over there. And I mean, like, you know, and the guy in the video was talking about, oh, like, the Americans and the British, they got killed a little. And I'm, you know, like, the thing is, it's like, it's a war, you know? Like, everyone isn't going to live. That's the unfortunate truth of it. And so this guy, I guess he went in with the idea that it was going to be like Battlefield 4 or Call of Duty, in the way that the main characters don't die, but there's no such thing as a main character in a war. And so he saw people around him die, and he was like, oh my god, you know? And like, I don't really know about those statements. I mean, like, maybe there is a bit of truth to the lack of air support. The Ukrainian Air Force is small, and we do know that they have been taking losses over the entirety of the war, and so that's one of the reasons why they're desperately demanding jets from the West, so that way they can replenish the numbers of jets that they have lost. But I can't really talk about it too much, because there's not a lot of proof that video showed to me that he was actually anywhere around there. He was wearing normal clothes. The background he was in was like a 5-star hotel you would find in like Atlanta, Georgia. And he didn't look like he was anywhere around a war zone, or had been, or anything like that. He was just sitting in a hotel lobby talking on to his phone. And I was like, I don't really know about that. He didn't back up a lot of his accounts with proof to show that he was a foreign fighter or anything like that. And on top of that, if he said they were getting no training, the Ukrainians require you to have a minimum amount of military training to volunteer. So I don't really understand where he's coming up with the idea that they would train him, because it's supposed to be a prerequisite that they already have military experience and so therefore have training. So, I mean, that was another thing that kind of threw a wrench in the validity to me. But I thank you very much for the support, and I thank you for the question. It's actually a pretty good question. I've seen those videos myself and have kind of like questioned them, like, what's up with that? So thank you very much once again, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, so the next question is from Duncan VR. He asks, next coffee is on me. Keep the good info coming. Question, is there a total up-to-date count of destroyed Russian tanks, choppers, jets, APCs, etc.?
I believe the Kyiv Independent, thank you very much for the support, by the way, but I believe the Kyiv Independent comes out with a list of the amount of personnel killed, vehicles destroyed, and so on, about every single day. Let me check that, though. Actually, we can see if that's true right now. Twitter, Kyiv Independent. And while the numbers may be skewed a little, I do believe that they're giving the most accurate numbers as possible, given the circumstances, because no one can really verify the numbers at all. And I don't really think we're going to find them here. But Kyiv independent Russian losses. Let's see if we can just find a picture of the spreadsheet. So this one's for March 18th here, from what it says. Okay, apparently not. It said it right there. Well, I mean, I saw on the Kyiv Independent. Unfortunately, I don't want to burn everyone's time trying to find it, but they do give as accurate as possible an update on the amount of destroyed vehicles and personnel daily, although it is subject to be a little bit skewed, either too high or too low. We're not really sure because everyone in the world, the British, the Americans, the Germans, and so on, all come up with different casualty reports every single day and also come up with entirely different frontline maps. And that's something I'd like to address as well, is that every once in a while I am able to snoop through the comments on the live chat every once in a while, and some people say, "Hey, you didn't account for this, man. Like, this map is wrong." What the thing is, though, is that no one has a correct map right now. Like, every map you see is not entirely true, not entirely depicting the situation, because there's a thing called the fog of war, and the fog of war is kind of like this general concept of we don't really know exactly everything going on, and so we don't know where every single Russian unit is, where all the front lines are exactly. If we knew that kind of information, then the Ukrainians should be winning this war. We would just send them that info immediately. They'd know where everything was, and they would just be winning. But that's not the case, you know, because the fog of war doesn't really allow us to see things as clearly as one would expect, because that's what happens in war. No one really knows where the front lines are all the time. You just have a general idea. And so my front lines are based off of video evidence that we've seen. And so that's why also this area here has turned red, because we've kept on seeing so much Russian activity in this one area that it can't be a breakthrough anymore. The Russians must have actually started pushing this way. So now it's gone from purple to red, and this one may also go from purple to red if we keep on getting repeated accounts of activity here, but we are not. So just wanted to let everyone know that before we move on to the next question, that my map is as accurate as possible based off of video evidence, but every map is inaccurate to a point, and so there are inaccuracies in my map, and we're constantly trying to get more information to adjust it accordingly and make sure that it does show what's happening on the battlefield as best as possible. But I thank you once again for the support, and I hope I answered your question. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next one.
Next question up is from Timothy Hardesty. He puts in a $20 donation and he says, "Good job."
Thank you very much for the support, and thank you once again for the $20. It means a lot, and it helps us continue to run this channel. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Jacob. He says, "Russia seems to have air superiority. Zelensky isn't hiding. How is Ukraine keeping him safe from bombs dropping from the sky? And glory to Ukraine."
Thank you very much. And I don't really know. I mean, like, that's a very good question. And I can't really give an answer to that because I don't really know how he gets out and about in the city and wanders around and nothing happens to him. I think it's a miracle. I think it may be something beyond just normal control, because there's really no way to explain how he gets out and he's safe. You know, I don't really know how to explain that. So, I mean, like, if we were to assume that the Russians have air superiority, there is no way to explain that. But we don't know that entirely for sure. I believe the Ukrainians are still contesting the airspace due to their, at least their ground AA forces. So, if we go off of that assumption, they may be protecting them because there's a large amount of anti-air defenses around Kyiv, and so it's not subject to air attacks as much as the rest of the cities, but it's subject to a lot of cruise missile attacks and artillery barrages and so on, because we haven't gotten a lot of proof after the first week or so of air attacks occurring on Kyiv. We've seen a lot of cruise missile attacks and a lot of artillery attacks, but we've never seen aircraft really attacking it. So that may be the reason, but we don't really have a lot of information to go either way on that. So it may be that he just is lucky, and every time he gets out there, nothing happens to him just because. Or it could be because they have a lot of air defense around the city, and so that contests the airspace and makes it dangerous enough that the Russians w really aren't willing to dedicate a lot of aircraft to trying to randomly find him and kill him. So that being said, thank you very much for the support, and I hope I answered that question in a good, meaningful way. And so we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and the next question is from Commander Corvus Corax Nevermore. He puts in a donation of $50, And he says, please give your analysis of the logistics of arms flow into Western Ukraine, given the Russian strikes there. Thank you for your coverage and great videos, and be safe.
Thank you very much for the support. And we don't have a lot of information about the Western logistics as far as how the Ukrainians are operating it. Because here's what we know. It's well documented that they're either that the West is either sending in truck convoys or trains with full loads of, you know, rail cars into Ukraine. And then once they go into Ukraine, we don't know anything about them. And so I can't really answer how the logistics are operating over here. We know that in Lviv, we'll get to this later today, the missile attacks weren't directed at this rail yard. They were apparently directed at something else around the city, but it wasn't the rail yard. So we know that as far as everything is concerned with that, it wasn't attacking the rail logistics of the country. It was apparently attacking something else. So we know that the railroads are intact there at Lviv and from there to the rest of Europe. However, we don't know about the road logistics. I don't really know how those are working, and we really don't know anything, like, once again, once it goes into Ukraine, because they're trying to keep the stuff as quiet as possible, because they kind of, like, publicize, oh, you know, like, most of our convoys drive from Lviv to Vinnytsia, and then it drives north to Zhytomyr, and then it drives over to Kyiv. Like, that would give the Russians a great idea of, hey, we need to dedicate a whole bunch of attack aircraft to just start flying sorties over that highway, like this stretch of road, every single day, and we're going to be catching convoys all over the place. And so we don't really have a lot of information on that, because they don't want to publicize how their logistics is operating, because it may give the Russians a bit of an extra hand on information they didn't know or have before that. And so I can't really say, but we do know that for the most part, Poland has kind of become the logistics center of the Western world in terms of supplying Ukraine. Most supplies are flown in or just driven in to Poland, put into supply depots probably, to be redistributed onto other vehicles. They're then loaded onto more vehicles or trains, and then they're transported across the border and maybe put directly into Ukrainian hands, or the Western logistics groups and trucks and so on continue to carry it on to a destination further inside of Ukraine. But we really can't tell either way. So I'm sorry I can't answer that question too well due to a lack of information, but I thank you very much once again for your support. And I also like your name. It's a really cool name. And so that being said, we're going to move on to one more question, and then we're going to start covering the Eastern Front.
All right. And the next one is from Nick P. He puts in a donation of $20 Canadian. He says, it's a quote from Lao Tzu. He says, there is no greater danger than underestimating your opponent. Slava Ukraini.
Thank you very much, Slava Ukraina. And also, yes, that's entirely true. We can see multiple times that that's been the Soviet stratagem in a war, is just underestimate the opponent. They did it with Finland. They did it with Poland in 1920. A lot of y'all may have not known about the Sino-Polish War of 1920, but the Russians actually tried to invade Poland, and they failed. And so that's another example of the Russians underestimating their enemy. And they did that as well in Afghanistan, and now they're doing it in Ukraine. And they also did it in Chechnya as well. But, you know, that's not really like an official full-scale war on a foreign country. That was kind of like an internal affair. But nonetheless, we can see that they continue to underestimate their enemies. So apparently they're not taking anything from that quote. So I thank you very much for the support. And I also thank you for giving us that quote, because it did help me to jog my memory for a second and remember what happened in Poland in 1920. By the way, if y'all want to check that out, make sure to open up a new tab and check that out while I'm talking, because y'all may be interested to know that in 1920, Poland saved Western Europe from a wave of communism that may have just flowed through all of Europe if Poland was to have fallen. So that was a really interesting story. Make sure to go check that out. And now that we've covered all the questions for the first set of questions, we're now going to move to the location unknowns. And today, we've had a huge amount of them. That's maybe why there wasn't so much in the northern area around Kyiv, is because the locations weren't identified, and so they went into this location unknown right here. So we can see here that the Ukrainians spotted an APC in an open field. They said, oh, look, an APC, and then they just shot it with an in-law and then wandered off. Check this out. Sorry for the grainy footage, by the way, but the vehicle is right there. He just hit it, and now he hit it. He's going to scoot away and then run off. You can see he's running right there. You know something? I mean, I don't like to make a lot of jokes, but for some reason, like, this has, like, the feel of someone who pulled a prank on someone else and then uploaded it to America's Funniest Home Videos. I don't know why, but this video was kind of like filmed in that format. You know, it's just odd how this was filmed. But still, nonetheless, it's great to see more Russian vehicles being destroyed. They're being destroyed on a countless basis every day. From what we can tell, the Russians are losing vehicles at a pace that they can just never keep up with or replace. So we're going to move on to the next bit of news. And we've seen that the Ukrainians have started to improvise drones to drop RPG charges. And it appears to be being met with great success. It says that the head of the Odessa Oblast said this, but the thing to me is that the head of the Odessa Oblast said this, but it didn't say anything about it being in the Odessa Oblast, like this event. So it went under a location unknown. So if y'all are wondering about that, that's why. So you can see the little RPG shell falling towards this building, apparently. It hit it, and then it exploded. I don't really know if that was a building or a vehicle. I can't really tell because the footage is so grainy, and then the structure, whatever it is, that's kind of like highlighted in black. I really can't tell what it is. Maybe they're vehicles. Yeah, I think they're actually vehicles. That kind of looks like a BTR right there. Imagine getting a quadcopter from the store, strapping RPG 7 like projectiles, missiles, or rockets, or whatever you'd like to call it, to the bottom of it that you then drop on APCs. You know, if the Russians actually were alive to know what they were hit by afterwards, I bet you they were absolutely seething that the Ukrainians are beating them with like store-bought drones from like Brookstone or whatever that little store is called that's usually in the malls that sells like overpriced tech. So we're now going to move on to the next bit of news, and we can see that Russian tanks were destroyed in this video by a Stugna P. And I'm going to show you all this right now. It's kind of run-of-the-mill stuff, of course. Let me rewind so that we can see that a little bit better. But the tank is right there where the crosshairs are. You can see it explodes, and then the ammo cooks off. It's very interesting. It's always interesting to me that whenever these tanks are hit, everyone has like almost the same response. It's like cheering, and then you know in that one video they all went yeah at like the same time. But nonetheless, everyone's always celebrating and cheering to knock out these tanks every single time. And you know that must be a real high to know that you took out a tank without one. You know, they don't have a tank, they just have an ATGM, yet they took this tank out, which must have been incredibly cool to them. And they'll probably be very proud of that well after the war and be telling stories about how they were taking out tanks in the war with nothing more than a Stugna. So we're going to move on to this next video. When you see in this one that a tank started to fire at civilians, I'm just going to let y'all watch this video without any commentary. It speaks for itself. So just watch and see this for yourselves. It's unbelievable.
Назад нахуй, назад, Саня, мы не пройдем. Блядь. Иди.
Куда мы идем? Пошло, блядь.
Вон, убей! Саня, быстрее! Слива!
That's really something, honestly. You could actually see one of the bullets pass through the front windshield. I don't know what direction it came from, but nonetheless, you can see the damage. And it's just crazy to me that we're 3 weeks into this war now, and the Russians just keep on targeting civilians more and more in these videos. I mean, it's insane at this point. Like, they're practically hunting them. So I'm not going to talk about that too much. Y'all know what I think about this at this point. If you're new to the channel, by the way, welcome. There's a whole bunch of extra streams you can watch if you like this one and the news that I'm covering. But it's just, what happened there was outrageous. So we're going to move on to the next video, and we're going to see a Ukrainian firefight. This is the Ukrainians getting back at this Russian scum that's in their country. So I'm going to show y'all this video. It's very good to see. So here we go. He's just waiting for the moment to strike, and there we go. Unfortunately, you can't see too much, but he is laying down the fire. I hope that man gives the Russians hell on earth. I bet you he actually did, because it seemed like they caught the Russians off guard in the woods. So it's great. It's amazing. And I've seen and said a lot of things multiple times, because the wars kind of become repetitive in a way and what happens in them. But nonetheless, everyone here is concerned and cares about what's going on in Ukraine every day. But I have to say this over and over and over, that the Ukrainian soldiers are some of the bravest people that I've ever seen. And we don't know if those were actual regular contract soldiers, or if those were members of a TDU or a TDF, whatever they're calling them nowadays, because I believe they're kind of switching in between TDU and F now. But it's just amazing. I mean, like, they had no cover, really. They had nowhere to hide. They were just sitting behind trees, and they just sat out there and were waiting for a Russian unit to move up towards them or move past them, and then just started wiping the thing out. Hopefully, it went well. Apparently, it must have gone well, because the footage has gotten out and was uploaded to the internet, so apparently they did live. So it's just great to see that the Ukrainians are still giving them hell all over the place. I've got to say, I've got nothing but admiration for the Ukrainian people. They are some of the bravest people that I've seen in the modern world. And I'm sure there's a lot of brave people around the world, not to discredit every other country. It's just that they haven't ever gotten the chance to show how brave their people truly are. But the Ukrainians have had the occasion, and the people have risen to it. And I just have to say, with a million times over, and probably will never stop saying it until the end of my days, that these people are just incredibly brave, and I have the utmost respect for every single citizen, every single politician, and every single soldier that's currently fighting or helping the war effort over there right now. So now I'm going to show y'all this video. We actually have two of these, but we'll get to the second one later. A Tochka-U was operating in the night. I'm not really sure. Okay, this was by the Ukrainians. They appear to be launching a decent amount of these, so I'm just going to show the video. There it goes. And off it goes into the distance. It's always good to see that the Ukrainians are starting to field a more impressive weaponry. You'll see it in the daylight and actually see the true scale of a Tochka missile. I'm assuming that it's probably a cruise missile due to its size, but we can pull that up real quick and see. Because I'm not an expert on every single Russian weapon, I'll just have that said. So it is a ballistic missile. So let's see if we can get a range on this thing. So it's accurate up to 150 meters, so that means it's about, for all of my American viewers, about 1.5 football fields off from the target, either north, south, east, or west, or it could be dead on. So you've got kind of like this radius that it's accurate to. The maximum speed is Mach 5.3. I don't believe that we have a range on this, unfortunately. Unfortunately, we do not. But we can tell that it's apparently a very large missile. And it's got a... I know it doesn't have a nuclear warhead. It just said 100 kiloton nuclear warhead. I was like, wait a minute. I was like, that can't be the case. So apparently it can carry fragmentation filling or an EMP charge or a chemical weapon of some kind or a nuclear warhead. We know the Ukrainians don't have any of those, sadly, or else they would have taken care of the Russian problem a while ago. So that being said, we're going to move on. We've gotten some interesting information about the Tochka. And so since we're already on the topic of the Tochka, I'm going to show y'all it firing during the day so that way you can actually see what it looks like. And so here's that video. Now Now, I'm no expert when it comes to ballistic missiles nor the yield of that specific ballistic missile, but I'm going to assume that it'll at least cause an amount of damage somewhere in between a lot and a little. So we're going to move on from the Tachka now. We've seen a decent amount of them being used. It appears, in all seriousness, moving on from a little bit of the joke, but it appears in all seriousness that the Ukrainians are starting to use these to great effect, which may suggest that they're seeing or figuring out that there may be some replacement or some way to continually supply their Tachka units with similar ballistic missiles, if not the same ones. So we'll have to see in the coming days if this becomes a normal, typical thing for the Ukrainians to start deploying and using Tachkas. We don't know what they're trying to hit with them, but we do know that they are being launched in a high number. So we're not entirely sure if they're trying to hit bases and compounds inside of Russia, kind of like they did with the army armory in Kursk or the aircraft at the airfield at Rostov-on-Don a while ago. But they may be starting to try and do that sort of stuff again to at least try and defeat this invasion a little bit quicker. And it appears that whatever they're doing, even if that's not the direct cause of it, is starting to cause some concerns in Russia. And we do have a video of a speech that Putin gave last night in the middle of our stream yesterday that I'm going to show here at the end as the last bit of news. And it's very concerning and kind of foreboding. But we'll save that till the very end because that's international news and we're here for the current frontline news. We're now going to move on to the next bit of news that we've seen, and we've seen another Ukrainian firefight in the woods in a different location. I'll show you all this right now. As we can see, it appears that they're dragging off what may be a wounded Ukrainian. Now they're in a firefight. As you can see, he's trying to get a view of what's going on out there with the camera, but it appears that we can't really see much right now. This is actually one of the higher quality videos that's come out from a firefight. You know what's crazy to me? I'm going to pause this video because it pretty much ends after this, but I'd like to point out that this looks a lot like the American Southeast. I'm not saying that this video didn't happen in Ukraine. I'm just saying that the trees are so similar to the southeastern US. You could almost see this war just from this video alone actually happening down here in kind of like the Georgia, the Carolinas, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, or Mississippi, because the forests look so much similar to the ones we have here. It's just really weird. And it kind of like makes you think, wow, this could like something like this could happen on American soil. And you know, if you put yourself in those kinds of shoe in that kind of shoe, you could kind of see a lot better the perspective of the Ukrainians and how much it unsettles them that a war is happening in their country, and also why they're so dedicated to fight for it. Because of course you wouldn't want to just give up your land without a fight, considering that they love their country and their land. So we're going to move on from that video. We're now going to move on to the next one. And we can see in this video that the Ukrainians retook a village. This may have been over the course of the past several days because, you know, of course, they're not wanting to release footage that's almost live or instantaneous because that'll give the Russians a good heads up on where they are and what they're doing if they don't already know. But we can see that the 8th Separate Mountain Assault Battalion took this village. And I'm just going to show you all the video. It pretty much speaks for itself in a way. And how the cinematography was done, but nonetheless, here's the video. As we can see, we're just getting multiple different bits of footage of the Ukrainians setting up. It looks like we're having drone footage of the village itself. We can see here once again that the Ukrainians are preparing to mount this assault on the city. Here we can see two soldiers, not really sure which side, but they're now out and moving from a foxhole and crossing the street into a tree line, heading towards the next building. Now we can see it looks like they've circled around that building and they're now coming out towards the church. Now it appears that there was an explosion at what may have been a school. Now there's an explosion in a field near the school. And you see the group now moving up towards the church. I'm not sure if those are Ukrainian tanks or Russian tanks. I couldn't really get a good look at the markings. But we can see that the group of soldiers are now around the church. I'm sure that these are probably the Ukrainians because they're showing that they're retaking the city. But you can't be entirely sure, you know, those could be the Russian units they are fighting. So now we can see that they're moving, I assume, away from the church and down near some kind of shed or a shack. We can see another unit moving along the wall. So we can assume that these two groups are working together. It's very interesting to see the combat footage from the air, and I assume that the Ukrainians are perfectly fine with releasing this footage because it's well edited, and they must have put this together and spent some time doing it, and so that's why it's on the stream, because the Ukrainians must be more than happy to put this on here because it's showing us what they're doing. So I'm going to assume that these are Ukrainian tanks out here on the street because they're not firing at the infantry in the town. We can now see some of the smoke and such flying up from the town. It appears that it's taken some damage in the firefights, although they didn't actually show us what the firefights entailed of. We saw the two groups kind of in this area, but we didn't see the firefight unfold. We can also see that the tanks are still moving, so I'm going to assume that the people we saw in that video were Ukrainian soldiers and Ukrainian tanks, and that was them retaking the town. It's really interesting to actually see them take the town, and it also looks like from the footage, although, you know, the footage isn't representative of the entire battlefield and the entire town, but it didn't look like they had a lot of soldiers involved in retaking this town. Maybe around 20 at most, and maybe, you know, some more off camera, but it didn't take a lot to retake it. But then again, that's modern warfare, is being spread out for the most part, and it takes a much smaller group of people now to take a decent amount of land compared to older wars. So, you know, that, you know, I'm not entirely caught up to speed on how modern day tactics work, because, you know, I'm not military trained. I'm just going off of my basic knowledge, and it's more of a big picture kind of logistics thing. But looking at this footage of this battle that occurred on the ground, it's very interesting to just see how it unfolded and how they conducted it. So we're now going to move on to the next bit of news, where we can see that a Ka-52 was flying around and being used today, and we got some footage from the cockpit. I'm going to show you all this. It's really interesting. This is from inside of a Russian helicopter. And so we can see he's flying towards a field of smoke in the distance, and he's now firing unguided rockets at it. And it appears that the rocket fire was largely inaccurate, although this may be normal for helicopters. We can also see that the gunfire is inaccurate as well, as it's more of like a vertical spread all the way from down here in the field where my cursor is, all the way to beyond the tree line. It was just kind of like a line, and I guess he's hoping to have some of those shots hit amongst the trees. I don't know what that was pointing out. Apparently it's some kind of armored vehicle in the bushes. So I guess they're going to try and circle around and get that in a second. Looks like they're firing unguided rockets maybe in that direction. And there's the armored vehicle once again. I'm assuming it's Ukrainian. It appears that they haven't really done anything to it. We'll have to see if that's the case when they go around it again. And it looks like they're actually at a runway, which is really interesting to me. I wonder where this is, now that we can see that there's a runway in the footage. Apparently these are Ukrainian logistics vehicles, maybe. It appears that the crews may have already bailed out because one of the doors is left open. Mostly there's multiple helicopters involved in this. As we've been seeing multiple ones throughout all the footage, but I'm assuming that they're the only helicopter in the footage, so.
Take it.
they've landed in the field, but why? I wonder if they've taken damage. I'm just wondering why they've landed in this field. Then they pull out a rifle. I don't know what happened here. I wonder if... Huh. Oh, okay, so when we scroll down in the comments, I don't want to scroll down too far because things can go wild in Reddit chat sometimes, and I don't want YouTube to see that. But at 1:35, apparently, the pilot says that the helicopter's been hit, and he's going to conduct a forced landing. So while they were hitting Ukrainian units, and that seemed like to be a bad thing, actually, in the end, they had to force land the helicopter due to damage. And apparently, they didn't show that in the video, or let you at least hear the impacts of the bullets or whatever was hitting the helicopter damage it. But it's always good to know that the Ukrainians just keep on taking out Russia's best equipment. The Ka-52 is one of their best helicopters, and we can see in that video that they have taken down another one. Very good stuff. We're now going to move on to the next bit of news where we see a large Russian armored column somewhere in the area of Kharkiv, from what can be told from a viewer that I had talking to me earlier today. But I'm going to let y'all see this video. And it's pretty much just a large column. I'll just let y'all watch it and see what y'all think of it. See, just a massive column. Looks like T-80Us, perhaps. You know, the farmers are going to have a great time when these things actually get to where they're going, run out of gas, or get disabled to a point that the crew abandons them, and then they'll just roll up and take about a quarter of them. So it's always good to know that the Russians are still sending in care packages to the Ukrainian farmers. Always got to support people who support the Ukrainians. Yeah, hope you see what I did there. So we're now going to move on to the next bit of news. We can see that the Ukrainians handed it to the Russians in this video. I'm going to show you all this real quick. There was this Humvee is rolling through a field. I'm just going to show this to you. So he's rolling through the field, and they're scanning for enemy forces. You can see that they don't actually have a 50 cal mounted up there. It's actually some kind of Russian or Ukrainian-made machine gun. Similar caliber, though. It's a 50 caliber by 108. Like 12.7 by 108, I believe. Anyways, I just like to say this real quick. Apparently someone decided they were going to shoot at the gunner with an AK or some other kind of small arms. You can hear it in the video. And the Humvee just lit this man up and opened up a marmalade and jam company, probably, because this guy ceased to exist after this machine gun opened up on him, probably. But here we are once again. See that it doesn't look like the resistance has lasted long to his gunfire. But it's pretty it was just kind of a little bit funny how this guy, you know, with just a rifle out there in the field, some Russian, thought he was going to gun out the machine gunner on the Humvee and just tried to light up his little kind of like crow's nest, if you want to call it that. I know there's a better word for that, but unfortunately, right now I can't think of it. But he was going to try and light it up, but the entire thing is practically armored. He had bulletproof glass around the machine gun, and then he had kind of like a armor cage around the rest of him. So he was pretty safe from that. It'd be pretty hard for a rifleman to probably hit him, even at a closer range, especially since the ballistic glass on the front of the turret up there on the machine gun pretty much went much higher than the armor. So I don't really think anyone had much success wiping them out, because you could see that he just kept on firing at them throughout the entire course of the video. Always good to see that the Russians are always getting it handed to them, especially by the Humvee. So we're now going to move on to footage of more destroyed Russians. We can see here in this video. Oh, I'm sorry, that's copyrighted music. Let me make sure to mute that. And so we'll just have to watch it in silence. But you can see that it appears to be some kind of T-64 series, maybe, that was destroyed. You can see that there's more of them along the road, clearly marked with a Z. And it's just it's always good to see that the Russians just never get a break. it seems. They just constantly are losing vehicles, and they're making very little ground as well. Just more burning vehicles. I think this is another perspective of the same vehicles that were burning previously in the video. But always good stuff to see. Very happy to see that the Russians are not making much ground. They're getting pushed back, and we're still seeing the same level of destruction on Russian forces across the entirety of the country that we've been seeing for weeks now. And so now we're going to move on to the last bits of news that we've had today. And we can see that the first responders in an unknown city were saving children from the rubble. I'm going to let y'all see this video and just be quiet. It pretty much speaks for itself. It's very emotional. You can see that the first responders and some citizens, maybe just concerned citizens or the parents of these children, are trying to help dig them out of the rubble. But I'll just let y'all see it.
Да, это от снаряда. Дайте на 4. Не пускайте ее, не пускайте.
Держи.
Вот так новороссы, блядь, встречают нас.
I'm really at a loss for words. It's very hard to watch that video because, you know, the kid's just a poor kid. You know, he's nearly that kid's nearly a toddler. Just, you know, it's terrible. I mean, I don't even know what to say or where to go with that. I just know that it's infuriating to me to imagine that to happen to a kid. And we know that around 109 kids already about that age have been killed. And so just think about that. And hopefully that will inspire y'all to do something as well, because it's terrible. So we're going to move on to the next bit of news. We can see Russia's best here. We can see the clowns and the idiots who are causing this kind of pain on these poor kids and citizens of Ukraine. And so I'll show y'all this video. Unfortunately, I have to mute this one as well because it has copyright music. But you can see that the idiots are trying to turn this tank, and they have some guys on the engine bay. And so when the tank turns, one of the idiots just rolls off right there, you can see. So the tank rolls on away, just forgets the guy, and he's got to go climb in an armored car of some sort, like a retard. You know, it pisses me off so much to see stuff like that happen in the last video. And I usually get over this, and I try and contain my emotions and what I feel about the Russians as a whole. I know I always talk about always getting it handed to them, and that's good and stuff, but I usually try and get raw, unadulterated anger under control before a stream, because I do try and stay as neutral in reporting as possible. But I see a lot of videos like that daily, trying to find things for this news. And I put this one on here because this one, from what I was told, the kid was actually responsive later and lived, and so I didn't feel like this one would be too bad for anyone to see, but it would be infuriating. And seeing something like that reminds me of what I've gone through looking at the stuff earlier in the day, and seeing all the suffering that the Russians are inflicting on just poor innocent kids. You know, the kid's so young, as he's still wearing diapers. He has no clue what's going on. And yet the Russians are targeting residential buildings and so on, where things like this are inevitable and will happen. It's, you know, anyways, moving on to the next bit of news. The last bit of location unknown news we've gotten today is the Ukrainians in a super secret bunker calling in artillery on the Russians in the distance. So I'm going to let y'all see this. As we see out in the distance, the pop and plumes of artillery shells exploding. Good stuff. Hopefully they kill off enough Russians that they can avenge the suffering that that poor kid had to go through in the last video. So now we're going to move on to the area of Sumy. We can see here that we have a couple of events that have happened in Sumy today. Most of the time, Sumy is quiet. I'm assuming that the Russians have run out of an ability to mount large amounts of offensives at the same time, like they did at the beginning of the war. So we're either seeing offensives in small areas, or we're seeing them direct their supplies to defensives like they are around Kyiv. But nonetheless, the only bit of news we've gotten directly out of Sumy City today is that a warehouse has caught on fire today. As far as we know, no one was injured or killed, and the destruction of the storage compartment, nor the fire of it. But the fire was large, and apparently destroyed a decent amount of supplies. Hopefully the Ukrainians can recoup from that. Hopefully the West helps them gather up those supplies and maybe bring it back into the city, so the defenders are not in a very bad position or get in a worse position than they already are at. But the defenders of Sumy have held since the beginning of the war. It was only day two when Russian forces rolled through the city of Sumy and the fight for the city began. And they've been holding for around 20-something days now. And so I've got to give it to them. They haven't given up that city yet, and I don't believe they ever will. So now we're going to move on to the area of Trojanets, where we've had a bit of news today. There was a destroyed convoy near Trojanets, but apparently the link that was in this has disappeared, which is really weird. But nonetheless, it was kind of like last week's videos, where we just saw that it was just a convoy on the road that had been destroyed. Hopefully, a decent amount of Russians went along with it. We'll cover why today. I'm not really as... Because I've kind of flip-flopped a little bit in between sometimes here and there about some Russians don't support this war, and so we can't look at them as all bad. But today things have happened that suggest that most Russians do support this war. We'll get to that later, though, when we get to the international news. But nonetheless, hopefully a decent amount of Russians went up along with the convoy. And so now we're going to move on down to the Kharkiv area, where we're going to cover all of the news that has occurred in Kharkiv. Surprisingly enough, there has been a lot of news that came out of Kharkiv today. It appears that things have been somewhat quiet here as well, but we have seen that there have been abandoned SPGs and APCs on the outside of Kharkiv City again. So I'm going to show you all this video. You can see an MTLB right there, and a SPG, I'm not really sure if it's an S-23M, but I believe that is an S-23M. You see the inside of it, completely abandoned, still in running condition, most likely. But it's very good to know that, because the Ukrainians have started to repurpose these vehicles and use them for themselves. And hopefully this helps them replenish some of their depleted armor stores and help them continue on this war. And hopefully nothing bad comes out of them using them, like, you know, these vehicles are being tracked or something like that. I don't think the Russians actually have an ability to do that. But a BMP was also destroyed near the city of Kharkiv today, and we can hear it snap, crackling, and popping in the video. I'm going to let y'all see it. It's always good to see a destroyed BMP. Yeah, we all know that every single time a BMP is destroyed, that is another child that's been avenged in Ukraine for their wrongful killing. So we're going to check this out. You can hear the ammo popping and cooking off inside of the BMP. Just good stuff. It's always good to see the Russians getting wiped out like the dogs they are. So now we're going to move on into the middle of Kharkiv, and we're going to see pictures of Kharkiv before the invasion. Someone put this up today, and I thought this was a really good thing to show, because the city of Kharkiv before this war, and a lot of y'all may have not been introduced to Kharkiv until this war began and it became a focal battleground in this war. And so I want to show y'all some pictures of what Kharkiv looked like before the war began, because it was a very pretty city. So we can see here that this must have been one of the main municipal complexes, because they have a large Ukrainian flag up with a little Ukrainian flag in the flower bed. Also the seal of Ukraine in the middle of the flower bed as well. We can see here that they had beautiful little parks, and the buildings were very nice. You can tell they're rather old. I don't know how old they are, but they're a decent age. And everything in the city was just so nice looking. I mean, you know, people before the war kind of like considered everything in Eastern Europe as extremely poor and not well kept. And while that's true for some places of Ukraine, just like it's true that every country has its poor places, the actual interiors of their cities were incredibly pretty and beautiful. If you ever watch Bald and Bankrupt travel around Ukraine, it has a very nice quaint charm to it, even in the countryside areas, and it has a very nice city atmosphere, even for a post-Soviet country, because the Soviets made urban life bleak with the Khrushchevka commie blocks and such, because everything became very bland and just repeated itself over and over and over. But these pictures just show you how pretty Kharkiv was before this war. While it's not really pretty now, I'm sure that after this war, when the Ukrainians do win, they will start to rebuild this city, and it will look as pretty or even prettier than it did before, because I have a lot of hope in Ukraine, and if they can win this war, they can do anything. And it looks like they're already winning the war, and I know that once it's over, the whole entire world is probably going to come together to help them out in rebuilding their country from scratch, nearly, in some places. And I believe that while there's a lot of suffering and devastation going on right now, I think that the Ukraine that will come out of this war in terms of its infrastructure will be much better off than the Ukraine that went into this war, maybe. So the Russians may be, in a way, helping Ukraine kind of align itself with the Western world, even if they do have to declare neutrality after this war, and they'll become a much more prosperous nation due to the whole entire world becoming focused on them and, you know, their struggle and their people, who are very honorable and very admirable, really. I mean, I have nothing but praise for the Ukrainians and all and everyone who's fighting in the country and everyone who stayed in the country and the families who've unfortunately had to escape from Ukraine to protect their children, their wives, and so on. So that being said, we've now covered the entirety of the Eastern Front today. And so before I move on to the Southern Front, I'm going to answer some questions from the chat. And before I do, I just want to ask, Matthew, how many Super Chats do we have?
So it looks like we're sitting at about 30 to 35 Super Chats.
Wow. okay. We'll try and answer as many as we can right now, actually. So what is the first question?
All right. So the first question is from Eric Bloom with 255 Filipino pesos. He asks, you explained that Russia is probably not holding back on equipment. Is Russia likely to have additional manpower in reserve? Or have they committed most of their troops?
There was a bit of a mistruth that I used to say at the beginning of this war, is that the Russian army only had 285,000 active members. I actually found that that's untrue. That's actually the amount of soldiers that are on a contract, like in a contract with the military to serve for a certain period of time. While when you add in the number of conscripts that the Russian army has, which means that these people are required by law to serve, which is all male citizens between the ages of 18 and like 30, I believe, somewhere around there, they have to serve at least a year in between that time. And then they may get a letter in the mail that tells them you need to report for service for your 1 year service. But anyways, they'd have around 700,000, 750,000 active soldiers in the military, but while that's big and everything, you know, that's a big number, they can't dedicate all those troops to Ukraine. You have to consider that they do have other concerns. They do have to have shows of force near Finland, the Baltic states, maybe with Poland by staging soldiers in Belarus. They do have to face off against the Chinese, because while the Chinese and the Russians appear to be on somewhat amicable ground right now, they've really been kind of adversaries ever since the start. Even though China is a communist country and the Soviets were, they had a decent amount of clashes over the Manchurian border throughout pretty much their entire history together. So they do have to make sure that they have enough forces that they can counter any other threats and emergencies. So I don't think they'll be dedicating a sizable amount of forces to continue the invasion of Ukraine. And on top of that, you also have to consider that their logistics simply cannot allow for an increase of soldiers in that area right now. So if they were to add soldiers to this war in Ukraine, it would just be foolish, because there would be no way to supply them at the moment effectively. They would just be putting a strain on their logistics even further, and they would just end up grinding everything to a halt because they'd be trying to overstretch themselves. So to that degree, while they do have a lot of extra soldiers they could dedicate to this, practically it's not really possible. So I hope I've answered that question really well, and I hope you got what you're looking for out of it. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
So the next donation is from D.E. Bowen. He puts in a donation of $20. Mr. Bowen, we do appreciate your support very much. The next question is from Rabid Squirrel Garage, putting in a donation of $20. He asks, is this part of Putin's plan? Go in slowly and then come in full force.
No, I don't think that's a part of Putin's plan. I think, because you see, what it doesn't look impressive to anyone when a war starts grinding on for a really long amount of time. And modern warfare just is not geared for long wars. Modern warfare is geared towards having wars occur as fast as possible and getting it done with as soon as possible. Really, that's how every single war has been geared, because having a prolonged war is not good for your economy, is not good for the country, and it's not good for the military. It's not good in any way. So you're trying to wrap up wars as fast as possible. So I don't think the Russian strategy would be to make a slow war, hinder themselves greatly, and then roll in and stomp them. We've already seen that their equipment that they've deployed inside of Ukraine that has been destroyed on video is the best stuff they have. And so we already know that they're using the best things possible, and they're apparently using it in a high amount on the front lines and actively fighting as hard as they can, because they just have a large quantity of vehicles that have been destroyed. So I don't think that is their plan. I think their plan is to actually try and get this war done with as soon as possible. Also, due to political factors, it's very important for them to try and wrap this thing up really quickly, because it's very impressive propaganda-wise for you to just roll over a country. Like, you know, just start the war and 1 month later, you're in Lviv. Like, you've taken the whole entire country up to that point. That would be a lot more impressive than what they're doing. And there's a whole bunch of factors at play, but the most important thing is that modern wars are always, the goal of a modern war is always to conclude it quickly. So I don't really think that's Putin's plan. I think the plan was to take over the country really quickly. You can also check out a whole bunch of my prior streams, because I actually did discuss in a lot of them why I think the Russians thought the Ukrainian government would collapse within a day or two. But then that didn't turn out to be the case. And you could see in their first and second day battle plans and how they were conducting everything that they were doing, that showed to be the case. So I hope I've answered that question pretty well. And that being said, I thank you very much for the support, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. And the next question is from Knuckles. He puts in a donation of $100. He says, while I hate seeing innocent, beautiful children dying all over, nothing in war, I also understand, unfortunately, that's a part of war. When USA invaded Iraq, 7,299 civilians died, including at least 1,201 innocent children. USA is guilty also. Rest in peace, all innocent ones dying in war.
Thank you very much for the support. And while it is unfortunate that it happened in Iraq, I feel usually that's brought up to try and kind of make America as evil as Russia. And while I can see that in some ways, you know, because sometimes things did happen in that war that led to civilian casualties, of course, the numbers there to back it up. Right now, when you're talking about modern wars, the aim of a war is to always try and incur as little civilian casualties as possible. And modern war has been going further and further towards that aim. And so when you see the Russians blatantly disregarding that, while the Americans tried to control that as much as possible, like if you look at them trying to hit Saddam Hussein's compound, it wasn't that they were trying to hit civilian buildings, because they actually killed a decent amount of civilians in the process of trying to destroy his compound. It's that the cruise missiles aren't entirely accurate, and so all four of them that were supposed to hit his compound all missed, and they flew into residential buildings. That doesn't appear to be the case with the Russians, because you can see them actually firing shells from tanks, just normal artillery pieces, straight into apartment blocks. And the United States rarely did that, and if they did, it was because they knew for sure that there were enemy combatants in Iraq. I'm sorry, that was a very poorly put statement. There were enemy combatants inside of these buildings. That's a better way to put that, instead of saying they were in Iraq. Obviously, they were in Iraq. And also, the other thing is that the Russians completely deny this is going on. The Americans didn't, you see, because that was always a huge deal during Iraq and Afghanistan. I remember as a kid, if your parents had the news on, you would be watching the news, and they would be talking about, you know, today we're with American forces, and they're going to show us why they're not bombing civilians. Because there's been reports that they are, and we generally know that to be true in some cases, and so we're going to see how much they mitigate that. And I've talked to a lot of veterans, and they're always, one of their main things was always talking about how they try to avoid civilian casualties, and how some of the rules that they had to follow, if you want to put it that way, forbade them from shooting at certain fighters. Like in Afghanistan, I'll give you an example. I'm not going to say his name, but he was actually one of the commanders involved in one of the largest battles in Afghanistan, and I had the pleasure of knowing him and talking to him a bit. But he was talking about how the Taliban, the Mujahideen, or whatever group you would want to call them, because they were all kind of active at the same time during the Afghan war, they would gather up children, and they would walk amongst them, and then they would pretty much use the children as human shields and start shooting at the Americans with all these children around them. So, due to the rules, the Americans couldn't just launch a TOW missile at this guy and blow up him and the kids. They just couldn't shoot back at the guy. You know, or they had to try and draw him far enough away from the kids that a designated marksman or a sniper could kill the guy. So, while civilian casualties did happen in Iraq, you do have to remember that the United States didn't try and deny it. It was pretty much known whenever this happened to be the case. And the U.S. government was heavily detested for it, and they would apologize, and they make huge strides and efforts to try and not incur civilian casualties. But with Russia, they completely flat out deny it, to the point that their citizens don't even believe it's happening when their own family members call them and tell them what's happening. So there's kind of like a huge difference in between the two, because the American government and the Americans in general never made kind of a point to try and deny civilian casualties, even when Obama was doing the double taps, you know, and everyone was complaining about the double taps because there was the chance that they were killing civilians, because, you know, this truck or car or whatever could get hit. The drone doesn't orbit and it comes back, and by the time it comes back, a huge crowd has gathered around this car seeing what's going on in it. They launch another AGM at it. It hits the car, and then you're leveling a whole bunch of civilians. And the U.S. government never backtracked on any of that, never denied that happened. They just said, well, it happened, but we're doing that for national security. And then there was always a massive backlash to that, and you can still see that to this day, because it keeps on being brought up, because the Americans never denied it, and they always were trying to make strides, and for the most part, except for the drone strikes, to make sure that it didn't happen. So that's kind of the difference in between Russia and America, and that's why it's so much more important for the Russians, because they're flat out denying it, although there is clear and evident truth to the statement that they are actively targeting and trying to kill civilians. Just like that kid, just like the people in the car, just like that guy that got blown up by that tank in Mariupol. It's just clear and evident, and they're lying about it. But I thank you very much for the support. And so with that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. And the next question is from Brian McAllister. He puts in a donation of $20. He says, I really appreciate your channel, and thank you to you and all of the mods.
Thank you very much for the support, and I'm very thankful that y'all recognize the mods a lot, because they work in the background in the chat. Well, that's not really the background, but for me, since I can't see the video nor the chat, it's kind of the background to me. But they work so hard on everything. They work in the server. They work on this live chat. They've helped me out so much. I'd like to give a special thanks to Drew, who used to do the questions for me. He was incredible when he did it. Unfortunately, he had to get pulled away because of certain things in his life. He may not be able to come back, sadly, but I thank him so much for it. He did a huge effort. I also like to thank Paul. Paul did this for one night, and I'm very thankful that he did it for that one night. He was incredibly good while he did it. And then on top of that, I give credit to all the mods that haven't even done the questions, because they still work nonstop moderating that chat, and I just have to give them all the highest thanks I can. And so I thank you very much for giving support to my channel and my mods. And so with that being said, we're moving on to the next question.
All right. And the next question is from Anthony K. Smith. He says, secondly, Crimea is only recognized as Russian territory by Russia and lapdog crony countries. Ukraine can go get it. Go and take it back, Ukraine.
I can agree, but that would be tough, because the Russians would take a really strong stance on that and might threaten them with nuclear war, considering that they do recognize it as a Russian land and kind of a Russian state or an oblast at this point. And so going in and trying to take that would be somewhat serious. But maybe, just maybe, if the Ukrainians were able to turn this war around and actually start pushing the Russians out of Ukraine, maybe they could focus a really good deal of effort on retaking Crimea and see if that's something they can do. I'm not really sure if that can happen, although I do have a lot of hope and high expectations for the Ukrainians, but we'll just have to see. Maybe they could do that, and if they can, I will do nothing but cheer them on in reclaiming their lost land. And so, thank you very much for the support and the comment, and we're going to move on to the last question for this section, and then I'll get to everyone else's at the end, and we'll cover the Southern Front news for everyone who's here for the news.
Okay, so the last question here is from Joe Person. He says, assuming it's true that Russian ships are moving towards the Black Sea, how soon could they be engaged?
I'm not entirely sure. It could be any amount of time. We don't really know the Russians' exact plans right now. We do know that they're kind of in the area, but we don't really know if they're going to dedicate soon or later. We don't really know if it's contingent on the forces near Kherson, you know, and it may not ever happen now, retaking Mykolaiv and then pushing towards Odessa, and then we might see that occur. But we're not entirely sure, so I'm sorry about that, but I'm going to have to kind of plead ignorance a little bit on that one, because we're just going to have to wait and see how everything unfolds to start getting a better picture of when that will happen. But I thank you very much for the question and the support, and with that being said, we're now going to move on to the Southern Front and the rest of the country, and then the international news all in one fell swoop. So the first thing that we've got is that near Severodonetsk, we can see that DNR or LPR artillery has been working to bombard the city, as we can see right here. Hopefully a counter artillery strike will get them and knock them out. As we know, they're probably just targeting some random area of the city. They don't even know if there's enemy. Well, they don't know if there's Ukrainian soldiers in there or not. And they're just going to start hitting civilians, killing kids, women, just people minding their own business. You know, whenever I see an artillery strike now, you know, after so much time of seeing this, it's been 23 days now that I've been watching the stuff all day, every day. You just know what's happening on the other end of that artillery. You know what's going downrange and what it's hitting. And it's sickening to see that, because you know the reality of what's happening at the other end. So we're going to move on to the next bit of news. We can see the Ukrainians fire, and we can see Ukrainian fire landing in Russian trenches. It appears that they're trying to hit fortified locations in the Donbass here, and so I'm going to show you all that. And you see they got a sweet little trench work, kind of like World War I. We're going to see that they're going to start messing with that a little by dropping shells straight down into the trenches. So it looks like we're going to get a replay of that. So actually it looks like it hit just right behind the trench, but kind of like on the lip of it. So hopefully it got someone or something down there, because that would just be good, you know? It'd just be good to inflict some damage on the Russians and make sure that they're always freaked out and keeping on their toes in a way. And so now we've really covered all the information in the Donbass. We don't really get a lot of video reports or information from the Donbass whatsoever, which is kind of suggesting to me that my original assumption that this area is too heavily fortified for the Russians to really do anything meaningful through it may be true, because we've gotten no information to show that there's been massive gains here. But I may be wrong, and in the coming days we may get video evidence to show that that's not the case. But until then, I'm going to assume that that is what is happening and why the front line and the video reports haven't really moved since the beginning of the war. And so now we're going to move on to Mariupol, where we're going to see a little bit of news today. It appears that things have gotten somewhat quiet in the city, but we can see once again the DPR is now shelling Mariupol with their own SPGs. I'll show you all that video right here. Gonna cut this video a little bit short. You get the picture. They're just sending volley fire after volley fire of artillery rounds downrange towards Mariupol. It appears that it's snowing in this video, so it may be snowing right now in the area of Mariupol. Another snowstorm may have come over Ukraine, which will only help the sweet, beautiful Rasputitsa that's occurring through most of the southern and eastern areas of the country. And hopefully we can see, hopefully we can assume that this will keep on well into the summer, perhaps, so that way it'll slow down the Russians a lot more. If that happens, then not just the world is on Ukraine's side, fate is on their side, because the Rasputitsa hinders Russian advances, planning, and their offensives greatly. So if that stays the case, the Ukrainians are in incredibly good shape, and if it doesn't stay the case, the Ukrainians are still in good shape. So we're now going to move on to the video that we've gotten from inside Mariupol today. We can see that there's been an airstrike on a metallurgical plant, which I believe it's this one down here in the south eastern side of the city. I'll just show you all the video and let you see it for yourselves. As you can see here, there's explosions happening inside of the plant. As you see, just billows of smoke coming out of the factory. From what it was said, I'm not entirely sure if this is true. This may have just been an assumption that someone said, but they said that a decent amount of the Azov Battalion soldiers were inside of this metallurgical plant because they're the main defenders. I believe they may be the only defenders of Mariupol at this point. So if that's the case and that's true, then hopefully they made it out alive, because they've been doing a damn good job at holding back the Russians for however long they've been doing it at this point, like 2 weeks nearly. And also, we know that the Azov Battalion, no matter what people say, you know, you can say that they're associated with neo-right-wing groups, all that stuff. Even if they are, we know that this is one of the most hardcore Ukrainian military units there is. They are the most steadfast and most hard fighting unit that the Ukrainian army fields. If that wasn't the case, we would have probably already seen them routed due to the lack of supplies in Mariupol, yet they still hold. So it's telling us that it must be true that this is one of the, like, crack units of Ukraine. And also we know that because they retook the city of Mariupol during the 2014 Donbass rebellion and kind of like war. So hopefully they made it out of that factory well, and they retreated to a safer location, or they held the factory and the bombs didn't do too much damage. Nonetheless, the situation in Mariupol will only get worse as time goes on. It's an unfortunate truth, but it is a truth nonetheless, that once the city is under siege and they start running out of supplies, things only start deteriorating from there. So we don't know how much longer they can hold on, but honestly, they've already held on longer than I thought they would. About 3 days ago, I said they'd probably hold on for the next day or 48 hours, and we can see that they're still holding on to most of the city today, or all of it. I'm not really sure what the case is regarding to that, but we do know that they're holding on to most of it, and that's a good thing as far as that goes. So now we're going to move on from Mariupol, and we're now going to move on to Melitopol, where we've seen footage of a supply convoy moving through the town. I'm going to show you all this real quick. So you can see it's mostly Kamaz trucks. I'm not really sure what kind of supplies they're carrying. Some of these look like they're command vehicles or something of that nature. Now it's repeating in a loop, but I'm not entirely sure what kind of supply convoy that is, but we do know that it passed through Melitopol going to somewhere else, maybe to Kherson or towards Zaporizhia or Mariupol. We're not entirely sure, because Melitopol is kind of the crossroads of all those locations. So now we're going to move on to the area of Kherson, where we've seen The Ukrainians attack Russian bases and supply in this drone footage today. We know that the Ukrainians have been using drones to great effect, and that's never stopped. So I'm going to let you all watch the video and enjoy the montage of destruction that the Ukrainians have been raining down on the Russians just nonstop. So you see they're just lighting up this tree line, destroying loads of vehicles, like you can see right there, and making sure that the Russians are just having a terrible time trying to actually commit to their offensives and plans that they've made for this war. We see more strikes lighting up this, what appears to be a tree line, maybe with a road in it. You can kind of see all the hot craters of that these missiles have created. I'm guessing that the drone was guiding an MLRS fire. So that's really neat. It's very good to see that the Ukrainians never let up on the Russians. Apparently they're close enough to be firing rocket artillery somewhere around Kherson, which is telling us that the news is still good. And so now we're going to go on to our bit of news near Mykolaiv, because we've seen that today they captured an S-26 near Mykolaiv. So I'm going to show you all this right here. Actually, I'm sorry, correction, it's a Mista. Sorry about that. Apparently that was mislabeled earlier. And so we can see nothing more than good news. There'll be another Mista that cannot appear in this year's Victory Day Parade, and at the going rate, I don't think they'll have any to bring to the Victory Day Parade. I think a large amount of these Mistas have been destroyed, more so than any other SPG I've seen in this war. We've just seen so much footage of different, I mean, like, they are certainly different Mistas being captured, and they're not trying to make it look like the same one's been captured over and over, because there's enough different about each one that we know that it is in fact multiple different Mistas, and then we've seen some of them get evaporated to the point that there's almost nothing left of them except for the gun. So now we're going to move on to the last bit of news that we've gotten, and today we've had more news of cruise missile attacks hitting very close to the border with Poland. I saw something, though. I have to mention mainstream news for a bit, not picking a side or anything, but I saw both sides of the news reporting that missiles were landing 43 miles from the Polish border, which was in Lviv. And so they were saying this is the closest that cruise missiles have ever gotten or enemy fire has ever gotten to NATO borders, and the war is only getting closer. The problem with that is that they said that about 5 days ago or so, when the military academy at Yavoriv was hit just 13 miles from the border. I don't know why the news feels the constant need, mainstream news that is, to lie about the situation, and the main reason is because they're trying to ramp up their views. And it's such a scummy thing to do, to lie and freak people out and just change the whole story to just get more viewership on TV. And I think that's really honestly what's killing mainstream news these days. Is it's not that they're picking political sides or anything, although I won't weigh in on that. It's that they're lying about the news blatantly, because if you just continuously watch the news, you know that the military academy at Yavoriv was only 13 miles away from the border, yet now they're talking about it's the closest it's gotten, and it's 43 miles away from the border, much further than Yavoriv was, and they're trying to hype it up. Like, every single day, they go through the thing of, oh, the Russians are almost in Kyiv, they're about to take it, and they just do that to freak people out and get them watching the news. It's not the case. They're lying to get views. I don't like that. It's dishonest and it's unethical, in my opinion. I think these people really need to understand what journalism is, and it's not trying to generate views. It's about reporting the real news. And I hope a lot of y'all can agree with me on that. And so now we're going to move on to Lviv, where we've seen that there was a missile attack in Lviv. Apparently 6 cruise missiles hit the city today in different locations and caused a decent amount of damage. As you can see here, there's a plume of fire and smoke in the distance. And now I'll show you all the aftermath of that damage up close in these pictures that we've gotten from one of the sites of one of the missile hits. Of course, probably comes to no surprise to any of you that the missile attack was actually inside of a residential area. It doesn't appear to have hit anything important from what we can tell, rather than in a residential block. You can't make this stuff up anymore. I mean, like, there's no way that anyone can say, and there's really no bait, there's no leg for the Russians to stand on, even at the beginning of the war, to say that they weren't attacking Ukrainian civilians outright. This is a direct attack on them. You can see that there was no strategic interests that they were targeting from this damage. You can see that it's all debris from buildings on the ground. We see nothing that is a military target, and yet they targeted cruise missiles to places like this. It just tells you all you need to know about the Russians. So now we're going to move on to our last bit of news today. Well, actually, we have two bits of international news. I forgot this, and I want to show you all this. This is really interesting. The Russians invaded Georgia in 2008-2009, and when they did that, they won, and they created two little fake states, although no one really officially recognizes them, and Georgia's borders encompass all of this. There's two countries, unofficial ones, inside of Georgia. There's this one here that's outlined by this kind of like dotted line called South Ossetia, and it was founded after the war, and it's technically an independent country of its own, although it's really just a puppet of the Russians. And then we have this country up here, and I forgot what it's called. It's called something like Abkhazan or Abkazan or something like that, something similar to that. But nonetheless, it's considered an independent country of its own as well. And it's just, you know, it's just really odd. It's just really odd to me that this is something that exists. And the Georgians, although they claim this land, they have no jurisdiction over it. They have, like, this little area has, like, their own little government, and it has its own police force and some different laws and such. And so they're pretty much independent countries. And now today, we can see that Russians are moving South Ossetian forces out of South Ossetia. I'm going to show you all that right here. And it's suggesting that they're having to start and draw up manpower pools from around the rest of the country. We know that these are heading to Ukraine because we can already see that they have the Javelin cages installed on the top of these tanks. Here we can see multiple MTLBs moving behind what appear to be some kind of T-72. We also have what appears to be another T-72, a T-72B, most likely, with another Javelin cage on top of it. I'm not really sure which one that was. It may have been a T-72B3, although I couldn't really see it too well to say. That is definitely a T-72B. And we can see here that there's some kind of tunnel through a hillside, and we can see the armored personnel carriers and tanks coming out the other side. Was that a Z-Kyle? I'm not really sure if that was or wasn't, but if it was, that's interesting for the Germans to be calling Ukraine full of fascists, yet the South Ossetians appear to be doing something very similar to a Z-Kyle. Hopefully everyone kind of catches on that as well as you know, with me, because that looked a lot like what they were doing. But let me know in the comments what you thought that was, because to me it looked very similar to that. But if y'all think different, I'd like to hear and I'd like to know. So now I'm going to move on to this speech. This I pulled off of YouTube today because the speech was just bizarre and it was very grave in what it said. I'm going to let y'all watch it. I'm going to break down a little bit of it as it's going through it. Let me mute that. Can you believe it? I run no ads on my video so y'all don't have to see ads, and now I'm seeing ads trying to get onto stuff for my video. So anyways, now I'm going to show y'all the speech.
Людей только за то, что они родом из России, подвергают настоящей травле сегодня. Отказывают медицинской помощи, изгоняют детей из школ, лишают работы их родителей. Запрещают русскую музыку, культуру, литературу. Пытаясь отменить Россию, Запад сорвал с себя все маски приличия, стал действовать по-хамски.
I like how he says that the West tore off its mask of decency and began to act boorishly, and that's coming from Satan himself. And we can, you know, on top of that, we can see them killing civilians all over the place in the thousands. And they're going to say that we started to act boorishly because we inflicted sanctions upon them and fired Russians at their jobs. That's ironic to me. But anyways, I'm going to let the video continue. And I like how he keeps on trying to bring up kind of like a German, you know, like World War II German imagery, you know, all the time. He's talking about the Ukrainians are fascists. Now he's trying to suggest that the Western countries are fascist because they're almost doing things that are similar to pogroms. And I think he's kind of stupid for saying pogroms. Because pogroms were when we gathered up Jews. Well, not we, like people. Well, actually, it was Russians actually that started off the first pogroms in Ukraine, because there's a large Jewish population in Ukraine, and they went down there and started committing pogroms on the Jews, and they started to beat them up, kill them, and run them out. And that's just hilarious that he's saying that in this context, because it's the Russians that really started off the whole pogrom thing in history. But anyways, we're going to let this keep on going.
Устраивали нацисты в Германии 30-х годов прошлого века. Мы понимаем, каким ресурсом обладает эта империя лжи.
I like how he says that we're an empire of lies, yet we can see that he directly lies about civilian casualties every single day and is lying about the Russian casualty statistics, among many other things. And we can see that this speech here is trying to address all the crumbling issues that they see in the background while not really raising an alarm to Russian citizens, I suppose.
Правда и справедливость, она все равно бессильна. Россия будет последовательно доводить свою позицию до всего мира. Безусловно, они будут пытаться делать ставку на так называемую пятую колонну, на национал-предателей, на тех, кто зарабатывает деньги здесь, у нас, а живет...
What's interesting to me is that he's starting to do the Stalinist talk, and a lot of people have said this today, and I have to entirely agree. This is getting into that Stalinist talk, calling people who make money in Russia but live abroad national traitors. We're going to see that he takes this down a dark turn here in a bit.
Коллективный Запад пытается расколоть наше общество, спекулируя на боевых потерях, на социально-экономических последствиях санкций, спровоцировать гражданское противостояние в России.
You know what's interesting is that in his admission of the Western world trying to do this to his country, he's admitting, since he's addressing it in a speech, that it apparently is having enough of an effect that he actually has to make a speech about it, which tells you that there must be a lot going on behind the scenes in Russia that even we are not seeing.
Но любой народ, а тем более российский народ, всегда сможет отличить истинных патриотов от подонков и предателей и просто выплюнет их, как случайно залетевшую в рот мошку, выплюнет на панель.
And here's the concerning language. He said, I am convinced that such a natural and necessary cleansing of society suggests that these people are going to be cleansed from the societal pull of Russia. And it's obvious in the wordage, but what does that really suggest? This kind of talk is what Stalin said when he started sending people to the gulags and started having them killed. Is this suggesting that, like, you know, I'm not trying to do like a opinion piece, like conspiracy theory thing here, because this is almost like outright, and I'm just trying to connect these dots here. Is this kind of suggesting that they're going to start imprisoning and executing political dissenters? It seems a lot like that, but let's see the rest of the speech and see if it continues to go down that route.
Убежден, такое естественное и необходимое самоочищение общества только укрепит нашу страну.
And we can see right here, he says, will only strengthen our country. It almost sounds like he's trying to start a culling of sorts and start wiping out the weak to favor the strong kind of thing. Now, if anyone's talking about fascist talk, this is that kind of fascist talk you're looking about, because he's talking about the weak people, the traitors, all that, you know. And you may remember that the Chancellor of Germany in 1939 said a lot of similar things to that as well about the Jews. And he said that these people are the weakest people in our society. They're the traitors. They're the ones that turned on us in World War I and made us lose the war. And we're going to cleanse these people from our society, and this will only strengthen our country and make sure that the proper people, the German people, succeed in this world. You gotta see the similarities in between what he's doing, claiming that he wants to reunite all Russian lands, and what he's saying here. It's evident at this point that if anyone's the fascist or so, it would be this guy, this devil right here. He looks like he's bloated and sick with the evil that's inside of him. But anyways, we're gonna let the video play.
Глубокие структурные изменения нашей экономики. И не буду скрывать, они будут непростыми. Приведут к временному росту инфляции и безработицы. В этой ситуации наша задача – минимизировать подобные риски. Ключевую роль в преодолении текущих проблем должен сыграть частный бизнес, который способен за короткое время перестроить логистику, найти новых поставщиков
All right, and here's another thing. He's admitted in the speech that the civilian side, the civilian economical side of the logistics, has fallen apart, and military logistics are nothing more than an extension of civilian logistics and supply. And so by admitting that civilian logistics has fallen apart, you're admitting that the military side of logistics, which had already fallen apart, must be completely destroyed at this point, perhaps. We'll have to see in the coming days if that shows to be true, and the markings that Putin is giving his economy start to show up in the Russian military. We've already seen it a good bit, but does this mean, since he's already talking about the serious setbacks of the logistics of the civilian world, does that also already include, or will that entail in the future, the Russian logistics and just entirely wipe them out? We'll have to see. So now that we've covered that, we're going to shut this out. Unfortunately, there was a bit of news that I could not show today. It was actually Putin's little rally that he held in that football stadium. Couldn't show that because it had music in it. And of course, if I play the music, although they're Russian bands, and since they're supporting Russia, they should have their copyrights revoked so that way we can use their music free. But I'm scared that YouTube will do something to my channel, and if they did, I wouldn't be able to upload videos for a week. And so I'll just kind of give you a little quick rundown, and this will be the end of the news for the day. So he held a rally, he sat there and talked pretty much the same stuff that he kind of said in here, talking about how they were going to get rid of the fascists, in a sense, in Ukraine, so on. It just made a huge patriotic deal about it. It looked kind of a little set up and staged, but regardless of that, we could see that there's an overwhelming amount of support, actually, for what Putin is doing. And so I don't really think anyone anymore, and this is kind of why I'm saying that it's good to wipe out the Russian filth in Ukraine that's currently there, can't really say anymore that a lot of Russians aren't on board with them, because if there wasn't a lot of people on board with them, we wouldn't have seen all those people at that stadium. Yet we did, tens of thousands of them, if not 100,000 of them. And so that suggests a decent bit. And so that being said, we've covered all the news for today, and now we're going to go to the questions. And so what do we got, Matthew?
Okay, Enforcer, so it looks like we have a little over 30 Super Chat questions to get to. So I'm going to start off with Joe with a donation of $30. They say, what do you think the chances are that Putin and his followers can be destroyed at some point, whether by his own people or through another war? Or do you believe this just goes on and on forever from one dictator to the next?
I think we had a big discussion about this, as the moderators and me did. And my kind of stance is that this is just a part of Russian culture to have an authoritarian leader like this. Because you can see all throughout history, they had the czars, then they had the Soviet premiers, now they have this devil here. And so I don't really believe this is going to change anytime in the future, but maybe we can wipe out this nut and maybe bring in a new one. Who knows? Hopefully we could. But thank you very much for the support. And that's really all I have on that, because that's like, that could really be a whole video on its own, a whole stream on its own, talking about Russian politics and stuff like that. We may do that in the future, though. So I thank you very much for the support. And with that being said, before we move on to the next question, I'd like to say that this will be the cutoff tonight for Super Chat. So if you'd like to Super Chat and get a question answered, make sure to do that tomorrow, because we'll be able to get to it. We won't be able to get to all of them tonight if you start Super Chatting after now. But we will answer everyone's questions who did a Super Chat at the moment. And so that being said, we're moving on to the next question.
All right. Up next, we have a question from A Random Trip with a donation of $20. They say, I heard that Putin also threatened Bosnia, one of those Slavic nations. Not sure if it was Bosnia, but if they joined NATO, Putin said that he would also invade them.
One second. I'm going to actually pull up a map of the NATO members. So apparently, let's check this out. Apparently, Austria, Ireland, is this in 2015? Let's see if we can get a more modern map from around 2019, perhaps. Find out on the map. Can we just, man, NATO isn't going to highlight this stuff for me. Let's see if we can just go onto Google Images and find the most modern map. Okay, so yes, you are correct. It appears that they haven't already joined. Apparently, they're one of the few countries in Europe to have not joined. I don't really know about any of that, so I'm going to have to plead ignorance, unfortunately, to Bosnia joining NATO and what Russia has threatened. But the fact of the matter is that there's really no way they could hold true on that promise Because look at all the logistics and under and like kind of like undertaking they'd have to do, that's the good word for it. Undertaking they'd have to do to get to Bosnia. They'd have to fly over NATO territory with Russian military aircraft and then start landing troops in Bosnia with absolutely no ground support whatsoever. That would not go well, I don't think. So I'm just gonna have to leave that at that. I thank you very much for the support and the question. It was a very interesting one. We may have to delve into later if anything starts to develop with that. And so I thank you very much once again, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and up next is a question from Colin McCone, I believe is how you pronounce it, for a donation of 100A. He says, "Thank you for your incredible coverage. Do you think that the Ukrainians should continue to target supply lines and vehicles or shift to targeting artillery and missile batteries to relieve the pressure on civilians?"
I believe that they should focus, although civilian casualties are unfortunate, I believe they should entirely focus on logistics. Because if you destroy the rocket launchers, you just got to think, while that's saving civilians for a short while, that's also freed up Russian logistics to then supply other units even better. And so I believe that it's better to try and keep the actual forces of Russia, the actual combat forces, the artillery, the infantry, the tanks, the armed personnel carriers, intact, so they're constantly guzzling supplies, but focusing on the logistics to the ninth degree, so that way you can sit there and wipe out their supplies and eventually just lead the Russians to abandon the tanks and also have a huge problem of having to supply all these intact vehicles. That would be my stance on it, but of course, the Russians do push and they conduct war with, combat units like tanks, armored personnel carriers, infantry, missile launchers, SPGs, so on. And so they do have to focus on destroying those. But I believe that the primary concern of the Ukrainians, and this is just my opinion, and I don't really have a lot of military experience to back this up, but I believe that their entire, fo well, most of their focus should be on destroying Russian logistics, which is more important to winning a war than the amount of tanks and vehicles they have is how well they can supply them. So I hope I have answered that question pretty well, and I thank you very much for the support. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
Next up, we have a $20 donation from Flora F. Flora, thank you very much for your support. Next up, we have a question from Skeeter K7TRD with a donation of $20. He says, "I don't watch network news anymore, and I get very angry at what I hear. I'm really enjoying your truthful view of what's going on, and thank you very much."
I thank you very much for the support, and I'm glad you agree with me. Some people don't, and that's fine. I understand people may want to get a variety of news, but I just feel like they do such scummy things, kind of like lying about the actual situation just to get more views. And I just feel like it's a degradation of the news, because all sides are always fighting about, oh, we report the truth news. Like you may remember that, a few years ago, CNN always came back from their commercial breaks with CNN, the most trusted name in news. And I find that such a joke to for any mainstream news company to claim that they're a trusted name in news. I mean, like, regardless of what party affiliation you fall under, because they just lie about everything. And you can see it clearly right now when they're always talking about, oh, the Russians are finally making it to Kyiv, they're just going to roll through and take the city. And it never materializes. They lie about even benign things like the weather just to get some viewership. Oh, this tornado is going to wipe out the whole state. And then you get on there and then they say, well, actually it was an E1 and it only knocked over one tree and killed a cat. And they do that with everything. So I thank you very much for the support and I'm glad you agree with me. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Notrick. He says, "Enforcer, I hope there are artists, architects, and engineers lining up to rebuild Ukraine. As an old soldier from the 80s, I am very anxious for our kids. The Ukrainians' bravery is uplifting."
It very much is. I have to entirely agree with you. And I do know that there's a decent amount of moderators in my server who said that they may actually go over there and help the Ukrainians rebuild. I don't have any experience in civil engineering. I know that Drew is actually in college right now for civil engineering, so he may have a promising future doing that. But then again, that's his own personal decision. And also, once again, I thank you very much for the support. And I do hope as well that the children stay safe, the Ukrainians win, and there's a whole load of people and governments lined up and willing to help out the Ukrainians in rebuilding their country once this war is over. So thank you once again, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and the next donation is from Ron Edwards. He leaves a donation of $10. Ron, thank you very much for your support. Next up is a name that I cannot pronounce, but I will put it in the chat with a donation of $10. They ask Russia here, my school teacher, oh, actually, this person is a Russian, they say. They say, my school teacher used to be one of the best people I knew. She is still teaching, involving children in bloody propaganda and posting hate speech on socials. I am shocked.
Wow, well, it's very interesting to know that we still have Russian viewers. I'm surprised that Russia hasn't been banned off of YouTube, or Russia has banned itself off of YouTube like they've done with Twitter and Instagram, I believe. But that's really interesting, and it's very interesting to hear that there are still some people in Russia, although I believe that they're now a minority from what we can tell, that do not support the war. But I do thank you very much for getting on here and supporting the channel. It shows that you're apparently picking the Ukrainian side, since I'm a pro-Ukrainian channel, and I thank you very much for that. And that's really interesting to hear about your teacher. And I, you know, once again, that kind of backs up my claim that most people are supporting this, and now they're going to teach the kids about hating Ukrainians, probably. And so, yeah, I guess that's just how it is these days in Russia. But I thank you very much for the support, and we're going to move on to the next question.
And next is a question from 3ID Raven. They ask, do you think Ukrainians have more actual battlefield experience with Javelin, in-laws, Panzerfaust 4s, also drones, more than their NATO partners? Do you think that some generals are raising brows with their tactics?
I don't really think they're raising any brows with their tactics. I believe most of it has been seen. Like, we've seen improvised drone usage in Syria and in the war with Armenia and Azerbaijan. We saw that as well. We've seen drone usage a decent bit, so I don't really think that's raising any eyebrows. And I don't think anyone can get as skilled in drone usage as the United States, because we've got that down to a science nearly. But I do believe that they have a lot more experience than any of their European counterparts at this point, because they actually have wartime experience using drones and operating them and actually conducting strikes on real military targets. And they have to use them to a large degree, of course, because it's a war, and so it's not just a limited training event, it's constantly every day for weeks on end. So I do believe that they have more experience than most of their European counterparts, but not more than everyone else. And I don't really believe, to recap again, that they're really raising eyebrows with their tactics, because we've seen most of them used elsewhere, but the Ukrainians have brought all of these kind of like new and technological advancements in fighting all together into their kind of like strategy of fighting this war, you know, improvised drones and ATGMs and so on. So I thank you very much for the question. I hope I answered it well enough. And with that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
And we have another question from Ron Edwards, and another donation of $10. Ron, we really do truly appreciate your support. He asks, would you talk about Donbass and the DNR? Why is there no Russian reporting from the DNR? It's so frustrating to see pro-Russian reports. Please go into the details.
The reason why we don't see a lot coming out of the DNR is because there's just not a lot of action happening there. Now, we did see some stuff a while ago when they were trying to take Volnovakha, and then we saw that went completely opposite of what they were expecting. They made a huge propaganda coup of it, actually, and they're like, the DPR is taking Volnovakha, and then the Ukrainians rolled back in and just floored them, like put their head on the side of a curb and busted their teeth out. It was an embarrassment. And so that's why you don't really hear a lot about the DNR, well, the DPR now, except for around Mariupol, because now that's all they have going for them. And on top of that, this kind of like front line here that they share, Luhansk and Donetsk does with Ukraine across the entirety of the eastern side of the country, is very heavily fortified by both sides. And so it's really more of a stalemate in these areas, although we have seen limited breakthroughs up near Severodonetsk. So I hope that answers your question. And I thank you very much once again for the support. And with that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
Freedom First leaves a donation of $10. And he says, I love this channel, my friend. Keep up the good work.
Thank you very much for the support. I'm glad that a lot of people are getting behind this channel. And hopefully we can keep up this momentum after the war, because we are going to be reporting on the aftermath of the war, what turned out to be true, what turned out to be false from the information we were getting during the streams. Although don't bank on this, because we're not entirely sure if this can happen, but I may actually fly over there, and we may actually get footage on the ground of Ukraine after the war and talk to people and do interviews and see how things are and actually get really in depth with the rebuilding of Ukraine, because we've done so much good already. We've already raised $29,000 for the Red Cross, and we're set to do another fundraiser this Sunday. And if we're able to do that much good, I'm sure we could do a whole bunch of good in trying to raise funds for rebuilding Ukraine once the war is over. So we're going to look into that and see if that's a possibility. I'm very thankful that you enjoy the content right now, too. I thank you very much for that. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
This question is from Spaceboy with a donation of $10. He says, Russia is claiming that Ukraine is not a separate country and it is part of Russia, but they forgot that the west part of Ukraine was part of Poland for centuries, and Lviv was a Polish town.
That is true. Yes, they do forget that actually the geography of Ukraine meant that it didn't really belong to the Russians much or at all through most of history, except for about into the late 1700s, I believe. The Russians came through and kind of subdued the Cossacks in a way and, you know, got like official ownership over Ukraine. But they didn't really control it a lot. And on top of that, they treated the Ukrainians poorly. Whatever you want to call the Ukrainians, depending on the historical time, the Cossacks, the Ukrainians, you know, whatever you want to call them, even the Kievan Rus, they have never been treated well by the actual Russians, you know, the Russians of Russia. And so I don't really know why they're acting like they just belong, they have ownership over Ukraine and they should integrate them into Russia, because they are not the same people. Culturally, they're entirely, well, they're not entirely different, but they're different enough that they're not the same people. So I don't really know where they're coming from with that. I believe that's some silly propaganda stuff, like they're trying to reunite all the German-speaking people kind of thing. And so I thank you very much for the support, and I hope that elaborates on that a little bit. And so we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and the next question is from Leroy Jenkins. He leaves a donation of $5. He says, the video with the Ukrainian firefight is odd, as the man at the beginning sounded like he was speaking French and said, the tank just went past me.
If that's the case, that may have been the Foreign Legion, which isn't really strange. There's been a lot of French volunteers in the Foreign Legion from what I've heard. So I don't really find that too odd, but it would be interesting if we actually did find out that was footage from the Foreign Legion. We do know, actually, this is kind of a funny story, and while I do love Reddit for getting a lot of relevant and pertinent information out, sometimes the people who dwell on Reddit can be a bit of a disservice, and to some of my viewers who don't know what Reddit is, it's kind of like an online forum that's very large and you can get a lot of information off of it. But anyways, a guy on Reddit went and joined the Foreign Legion, and then he took a picture of where he was and where all the Ukrainians were, and they were basing their forces out of a school gym. Like, they were having a quick like breakdown and briefing to send them where they should go. And then the Russians bombed the school afterwards. So pretty much this Redditor guy pretty much gave away the position of a load of Ukrainian soldiers and may have gotten some of them killed. So, you know, that being said, I hope I've elaborated on that enough, because I don't really want to go into that too much. That was just an embarrassment to how dumb that guy was. And so we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. And the next question is from Adrian Carter with a donation of $20. They say 60,000 Ukrainian troops that are almost encircled from a few days ago. What's the status? Also, how can I figure that out for the future?
I don't know where these 60,000 Ukrainian troops have been encircled. You'll have to tell me where. If you're talking about this eastern area, maybe. We don't have a lot of information to say that that's entirely true, but I do not know what you're talking about at the moment. I haven't gotten any information about that. So if you could elaborate maybe a little bit further and get back with our mods, maybe on our Discord server, they'll shoot something to me and I can maybe answer that question better. But right now I'm going to have to plead ignorance to that, because I don't actually know the specific event you're talking about, because I haven't heard any news about it. And so I thank you very much for the support. And with that being said, we're going to have to move on to the next question.
All right. And just to give a quick shout out to Joel Daisy, he leaves a $10 donation. Thank you very much for the support. Next question is from Paul Bokler with a donation of $5. He says, thanks for doing this. Keep it up.
Thank you very much for the support. It means a lot to us here at the channel. Helps us continue running it as usual. I bet everyone gets tired of hearing that spill, but I have to say that every time, because y'all don't know how important it really is to this channel and its continuance of being a channel. So we rely a lot on the support of the public. And so I thank you very much for the support. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question. Before we do, how many do we have left?
I think we have about 23, 22 left.
Got you. All right. So if, by the way, here's an important note. If we do get any more super chats, I'm afraid tonight that we're going to be going so far over time that we really won't even have an option to answer them. So if you're thinking about donating a super chat, remember tonight we will not be able to get to that question tonight if you have one. So make sure to save it for tomorrow because this comes on every day at 10 p.m. Eastern time. And so that being said, we're moving on to the next question.
All right, this question is from Anthony Smith. He says, yesterday's videos of an artillery attack on a Russian vehicle compound was actually an attack on the Russian 35th Army command post.
Oh, well, that adds a lot of extra detail to that. That's really interesting. I did not know that. And now that we do know that, we can maybe assume that their communications may have been knocked out for a while. Maybe. I don't really know how the Russians organized their communications, but that may have been something that occurred while they were trying to reorganize that command post. So I thank you very much for sharing that with us. I did not actually know that. And maybe that's why Russian generals are being killed, is maybe just they're at these command posts and then they just get bombarded. Maybe that's the case. But nonetheless, thank you very much for the support. And I thank you for sharing that with us because that's some very good information to know. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and just a shout out to Kang Tran, who leaves a donation of $5. He says, good job. Thank you very much, Kang, for the support. Next up is Jeremy Taker. He leaves a donation of $5. He says, do you think that Russians went into this thinking this was an easy win? Now they have their backs up against the wall trying to defend themselves.
I do think that they went into this thinking it was an easy win. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because that would take too long. But just based off of what they did at Hostomel, they landed 200 VDV troops at an airport and gave them no support and expected that that would actually work. And so going off of that, we can assume that they expected no resistance whatsoever, hardly. And so going off of that, we can assume that they thought that this was going to be a cakewalk, and now they're seeing that as a trip into hell. So thank you very much for the support, and I hope that answers your question. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next one.
Next up is a question from Sea Dog Pirate. He says, did you see the Wikipedia map showing a Russian blitzkrieg from the east?
I believe you were talking about the one up here near Perluki. I have, but we haven't gotten enough video evidence to show that they've passed Perluki, or they've even been up here near Borzna, Adjusha, or Bubrik. We haven't seen any of that. We saw them go to Konotov and like negotiate with the mayor by holding a hand grenade with a pin pulled, and then we saw some forces down here near Perluki, but we haven't gotten anything beyond that. So, while the Wikipedia map may be showing that, they may be getting that from CNN and Fox News, and they have a tendency, of course, really all the news networks have a tendency to exaggerate things that are going on to hype it up and get more viewership. So, as far as I know, video evidence-wise, that hasn't been the case. So, I thank you very much for the question. I hope that answers that to a good bit, as far as my knowledge is able to. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
Tito McLovin asks, the USS Ponce has an anti-air laser in use. Wouldn't it be wise to place the ANSEQ-3 laser weapon system in Ukraine? No evidence to find.
Not really sure. I'm sorry. I do try and have a wide knowledge of military weapons, but I do not know all of them. And so, unfortunately, I don't really know enough about that system to be able to talk about it either way. I would love to, you know, it would be nice to have all the time in the day to learn every single weapon system that every country uses. But sadly, I believe that one has been missed on my radar because I don't really know enough about it to talk about it. And so I'm sorry about that, but I'm going to have to plead ignorance to that question because I just don't know enough about that system to talk about it. So I thank you very much for the support, though. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from James Lynn, and bear with me on this one because it's a little complicated. He said, I didn't see it on your map. 79th Air ASLT BDE UKR HQ came under their attack today in Mykolaiv. Heavy casualties reported.
I think he was giving a whole bunch of abbreviations for brigade and all that stuff. I didn't actually see that. That's fine. That's hard to pick up on sometimes, but I didn't actually see that. And I actually have a decent amount of mods that help me gather and comb up info, and none of us saw it. So we'll look over the internet again. I'm sure that some of the mods are already looking over that right now to see if they can find something on it and see if that's the case. And if it is, we'll maybe include that in tomorrow's news or make a special note about that happening. But as far as we know, the only command post that we've heard about today was the one that was stricken up here near Kyiv last week, I believe. And it was apparently the command post for another brigade or an army. So thank you very much for the support. We'll look into that and get an answer on that. And with that being said, we're moving on to the next question.
The next question is from OG Wakanobi. They say the Russians failed in Finland too, the Winter War.
They did. And I've actually talked about that a lot. I referenced that war a lot to kind of like give a context to this one. So I highly suggest that you go back and watch the stream. I know you're actually a return viewer, but to everyone else, I highly suggest you go back and watch the other streams. I know they're incredibly long, but they do cover everything that happens every single day that we can find. And so they're very informative, and I draw a lot of comparisons in between this war and the Winter War because they share a lot logistically and tactically as far as the front lines are developing. So I thank you very much for the statement. It is very true, and the support as well. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Victor's Lab Notebook. He says, I feel like tech has reached a point that defenders have the advantage over invaders. Any maker in their garage can make equivalently deadly weaponry.
That's pretty true. But the main thing to think about is that wars have always favored the defender. If you ever look at any kind of war, usually the defenders have a large advantage because they can fight on their home turf. And on top of that, it's always been very easy to produce improvised weapons and field them in a decent amount, not as much as like a streamlined production line that produces like MP40s in World War II or something like that, or Kar 98s, you know, if we're talking about the German instance. But, you know, at the end of the war, they were able to easily produce the Volk, what was that group called? It was the it's a little militia group that they started creating at the end of the war. I forgot the name of it. I'm sorry, everyone. I do know the name of it in the back of my head somewhere. I just can't think of it right now. But they were able to produce crude guns for them and give them to them in a decent amount. So I believe that wars always favor the defender in terms of just producing stopgap technology and gear. So I hope that answers your question a bit. And I thank you very much for the support once again. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next one.
The BK Knight asks, of all the surprising things about this war, I find it hilarious that UCP is working so well. All that cheap surplus no one wanted went to Ukraine, LOL.
Yeah, I've noticed that a lot too, is that the Ukrainians were wearing that tacky looking camo. And I mean, like, you know, you can't complain much when the world's just giving you whatever. You got to take what you get. But it's just so funny to see that camo that was hated so much in the United States. I mean, like I think the military was like literally giving going away parties for that thing to get out of here and get a new camo pattern. And now we can see that thing being used all over Ukraine, and it appears to be working. So that's interesting to me. So I thank you very much for the comment on that, because I've been noticing that too, and the support as well. And with that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and just a quick shout out to B. Ledbetter with a donation of $5. They say, thanks again for the info and keep up the good work.
Thank you very much. And with that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, next up is a question from Ned J. 10. He says, the other day you showed a captured tracked AA unit and said it was a hand-aimed, but almost all Soviet AAs since the 1960s are radar-guided.
I'm not really sure which one you're talking about, but if you can clarify that, I may be able to talk about that a little bit more in depth. You may be talking about the little armored personnel carrier that kind of had like the gush gun on top of it. It looked like a gush. And so if you're talking about that, yeah, it's hand-aimed. They don't have any kind of computer system on that thing to guide it. They're actually just using, you know, like pretty much like gears. And they're just spinning the things around by hand. But I think I know what you're saying. Most of them are radar guided, but I don't think that one was, if you're talking about that one in particular. And that was actually, I think, days ago. But nonetheless, I thank you very much for the support. We'll look into that. And if you could help clarify that a little bit later, maybe in the Discord, I can get a more accurate answer on that, or maybe clear up that false statement if it is. But I thank you for the support nonetheless. And we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, just a heads up for everybody, we have about 15 super chats left. So next up is Mark Bohachuk, and it's good to see you again, Mark. He says, laptop problems. Can you start the stream over again? LOL, nah, here's your coffee money for the night.
Well, thank you very much. That's pretty good. That's a pretty good joke. I was kind of getting worried there that you're actually asking for that. I was like, oh man, I was like, I don't know if I can do this for another 2 hours. It takes a lot to produce this stream every night, and it takes a lot of help from the mods as well now. And I don't really know if I could do it again if I had to, you know, like if it just shut off and it couldn't come back on, I would probably have to call it a night because it'd just be too much to start from the beginning again. But I thank you very much for the support and the coffee money. You're constantly giving us the coffee money, and I thank you that for that a lot. And so with that being said, we're moving on to the next question.
All right. Next up, Mihoville P asks, Lieutenant General Andrei Mordvichev, commander of the 8th Combined Arms Army of the Southern Military District of the Russian Armed Forces, has been killed.
I believe he has. I think that, I don't know if that's today's news or a couple of days ago news, but yes, I believe I did hear that he was killed. So I thank you very much for bringing that up. We'll check to make sure that isn't a today thing and that's like a yesterday thing, because if not, then that is brand new news. But I thank you very much for that and the support as well. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and next up, Jacob Sabella asks, do you have any Mi-28 shot down videos?
I do not, actually. We've seen a lot of Ka-52s get shot down, but we've never actually seen a video of an Mi-28 being shot down or the wreckage thereafter. So unfortunately, the answer to that is no, we haven't. But I thank you very much for the support, and if we do get a video of that, I'll make sure to put it up on that night stream for sure, and that will not be something that is missed. So I thank you very much for the support, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and I just want to quickly give a shout out to two super chats that we just received. The Mustang One donates $20. We thank you very much for your support. And Captain Chris 1220 donates $20 as well and says, here's to the coffee money. Thanks to you and the mods.
Thank you very much to both of y'all for the support. Y'all have heard me give the entire spill before about how this helps out the channel, so I'll save y'all from that. But I thank y'all all once again because it means a lot to me. And so I just got to say thanks. It just means so much. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. Next up, we have a question from Geoff L. If a town is shelled by artillery or grad rockets, isn't it safe to assume the front line is within 20 miles of that town?
Yes, we can assume so. I believe that is the range of an MLRS. We can pull that up, though. Grad rocket range. 12 miles. So it actually be about 12. That town would actually be about 12 miles. But then apparently there's a modification, the GM modification, which increases the range to 17.1 miles. And then we know that a Smirch can actually reach out to about 50. So it kind of depends on what kind of rocket system it is or what kind of artillery system that's being fired. But the front line could be anywhere from, just a few miles away to around 50 miles away, depending on the rockets and the artillery being used. But that's actually a pretty good rule of thumb to see how far a front line could be. And so I thank you for bringing that up. That's actually a very interesting thing to think about. And also the support as well. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. And just a quick shout out to Gavin Summers. Thank you very much for your donation. We appreciate the support once again. Next question is from Chris Kaufman Jr. He says, every time a Russian tank is destroyed, an angel gets its wings.
That's right. That's also the truth when any, I may not make that joke on stream, but that's also true whenever a Russian tank commander gets his tank hit by an ATGM, he usually earns his wings as well. And I think some of my mods watching the stream might know what I'm talking about right then. But I thank you very much for the support and the statement. It's actually a pretty true one to most regards. But I'm not trying to say that Russian tank commanders are angels or anything. Actually, they're devils. But if you knew what I was talking about, which some of the moderators do, you'll know where I'm going with that. Thank you very much for the support nonetheless, and we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, next up we have Mark Bohachuk back at it again. He said, forgot the rum fund, here you go.
Thank you very much, and for everyone who's been holding their shot glass up to their lips all night and have been wondering when's the time to get plastered, it's right now. And that being said, take a sip, and we're going to move on to the next question.
Next question is from Kevin C. He says, do you think the $1 trillion in frozen assets will have litigation and claims against it for damages in Ukraine?
I'm not really sure if you're talking about frozen assets that the Ukrainians have overseas. Is that what you're taking that as, Matthew?
Yeah, he's asking, do you think that the $1 trillion in frozen assets are going to be litigated for the damages that happened in Ukraine?
Maybe. I mean, like, that's something that would be plausible. And I think if you're talking about Russian assets that have been frozen, there's trillions of dollars of Russian assets apparently that's held in, well, actually, I think it's like hundreds of billions or something within that range, although there's a huge range that is currently frozen in Switzerland. And who knows? I mean, maybe that would actually be litigated later on and given to Ukraine as kind of a reparation of sorts. But we'll have to see what the future holds. It could really go either way. Maybe they'll just unfreeze the assets, or they'll litigate it like you're thinking, which may be the case, and they give it to Ukraine. But nonetheless, I thank you very much for the support and the question. It's an interesting question I haven't actually thought about, so I may try and look into that. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
Next up, we have EthanTube98. He says he was late to the stream tonight, so here's another $5 for the great information.
Thank you very much for the support. And it's all right. You don't have to give a super chat just because you're late. I mean, like, that's totally fine. We've all got lives to live and stuff, so I understand if you're late. But once again, thank you very much for the super chat. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Chris Kennedy. He says, I saw that Japan is challenging Russia's claim on Kuril Island. Is there any efforts to support other conflicts like reigniting Chechnya, etc.?
I don't think there is, but Japan is doing something smart here, and they're making sure to align themselves with the West. They already are. I mean, like, they are pretty much a Western country at this point as far as politically, but they're making sure to take advantage of the situation and start demanding back the Kuril Islands, which is, I don't even think they're really populated, actually, but they're just islands that Japan used to own before World War II, and along with the Sakhalin Island. It was kind of taken back by the Russians in World War II. Both of those countries are still officially at war because they never signed a peace treaty. But, you know, nonetheless, that doesn't mean that they're going to just start shooting each other tomorrow. But we'll have to see if that leads to rekindlings of other uprisings or claims. I don't really think that'll happen in Grozny, though, but we'll have to see. But I thank you very much for the support and the question. It's a very interesting one and very thought-provoking. We'll have to actually think about that and maybe have some really interesting discussions, the mods and me, and maybe see what we're all thinking about it. But I thank you nonetheless, and that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Caffeine. He says, if music is used in a rally, you can stream it as long as it's in the rally. Mr. Lawyer, you should know this, LOL.
Well, unfortunately, that isn't always the case with YouTube. While that may be the case legally, perhaps, YouTube doesn't really see it like that. Because here's an example. I get copyright striked on these videos every once in a while. And it's not like a copyright strike where it shuts down the channel. It's just one where it demonetizes that video. But the thing is that sometimes I'm showing videos that were taken by Ukrainian citizens, yet a news company will claim that's theirs. And then they uphold that copyright. And so I do have to be very careful with YouTube, because if I do something like that, I could get in a lot of trouble regardless what I legally am allowed to do. I could get in trouble due to YouTube's policies. But once again, I thank you very much for the support and trying to clarify that for me. And that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right. I just want to go ahead and give a shout out to Mr. Misha 777 and also Brandenburg as well. Their donations came in a little late, but I wanted to make sure I recognized you both. Thank you very much for your support. Also, I want to recognize Laurie Gaddis as well for her $5 donation. Thank you very much. And next up, we have a question from longtime supporter Knuckles. He says, I asked about your thought on video, and I sent you in Discord yesterday, and you said you would look at it. Just wanted to know your thoughts. Keep up the good work.
I've got to be honest with you. I get a lot of messages per day, and as I looked at it, but I think I was so busy that I forgot what I was looking at. And I hate to say that. Make sure Matthew that he puts down his Discord name. Well, no, actually send me a message over Discord now if you can, to make sure to say, hey, I'm Knuckles. And I'm going to look at that and give you an answer right after the stream, because I'm very sorry that I forgot about that. And because I've got a lot of things going on in the day, and that's not really a good excuse. I should have remembered that and brought it up. So I'm sorry about that. But make sure to shoot me a little DM here and say, hey, I'm Knuckles. Make sure to check out this video again and tell me what you think. So that way I can get you an answer on that. I'm very sorry about that. But that being said, I thank you very much once again for your continued support, and I'm going to make sure not to let you down and get you an answer to that. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and the next donation is from Mrs. Boss to Ross for a $5 donation. They say, keep it up.
Thank you very much for the support. I'm glad that you enjoy the content, and we're going to keep on trying to deliver as much as possible even after the war is over. So I thank you once again, and that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
All right, and this is a question from Mr. Misha777 that was sent in earlier. He says, thanks for the daily info of the war in Ukraine. My question is, what are the chances that 5-star American generals are actively commanding the Ukrainian army?
I don't believe there's actually any 5-star generals at the moment. I believe that's kind of like an emergency wartime thing. I think the highest a general can get right now is 4 stars, which is just a general. But I don't think there's any of them commanding the Ukrainians that would involve America directly in the war. So I don't think that's the case, nor a possibility right now. But in the future, we may see something like that happen, depending on how the situation in the world unfolds with what Russia's been saying and what they're doing. But I thank you very much for the support nonetheless, and as of the moment, I don't think that would be the case, or a possibility even. But once again, thank you very much, and we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Takata Store. They want to know your input on the Japanese island retake situation.
I think that that's a decent amount of political posturing, but Japan will not commit to that, probably, actually trying to launch an amphibious invasion and take the Kuril Islands again. It would be a huge move. It would be very risky for them, because that could embroil them in a war with Russia. And, you know, while islands are very small and you wouldn't think that would actually lead to a war, if you remember the Falklands, it led to a war. And I think while they've rekindled the claim on it, I don't think they're actually going to pursue it, because it could lead to disastrous results on the world stage. But I thank you very much for the question. I hope I answered it to the best of my abilities, in my opinion. And you've got to remember once again that when I say things, it's not the way it is. It's just entirely my opinion. And I haven't been saying that a lot lately, but I think that's because I think everyone at this point knows it, and so I'm just omitting it at this point. But once again, I thank you very much for the support. And that being said, how many questions do we have left?
Looks like we just have one question left.
All right, let's hear it.
All right, and the question is from Maxi Mad. They say the Foreign Legion comment from Reddit was fake.
Okay, yeah, that video looked fake to me. If you're talking about the video of the guy who looked like he was sitting in a 5-star hotel, who looked like he had just come straight out of his basement with a neck beard and everything. If you're talking about that one, yeah, I saw that too, and I'm glad to get that confirmed. So, thank you very much for helping us out with that. Thank you very much once again for the support. And now we're going to answer 3 questions from the chat. Just any general question. And so what do we got, Matthew?
All right. And before I do that, I just want to recognize a couple of donations here that were made without a comment. We have one from Michael Fernandez, Jose L. Campuzano. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly. Another donation from Caffeine. A donation from VJ Mari, another donation from AI Tech, and finally, one last donation from Ron Edwards. Thank you all very much for the support. All these donations continue to help the channel to be able to run on its own, and we certainly appreciate it. And now, let me get to a couple of questions. So, we have a question from longtime supporter Patriots NFL1. He says, what, in your opinion, is the red line that would trigger us, meaning the USA, to get more directly involved?
I believe the red line would be, there's a couple of them. If an American vessel was attacked, like a neutral merchant ship that was flying American colors was attacked somewhere at sea, if there was any missiles that fell inside of Poland and actually caused significant damage or death, or if the Russians directly threaten war, not like a threat like they've been doing, like, you know, economic sanctions are close to war. I'm talking about we're on the border, and within 24 hours or 48 hours, y'all need to do something. Like, if they gave us an ultimatum, I believe that would actually force us to act immediately. So those three things I could really see leading into a war, well, leading us to get directly involved. But the relevance of will those happen or not is still up to debate. We don't really know if something like that will happen, but it's something that's plausible. So I thank you very much for the question. That's actually a pretty good one. And thank you so much for being a longtime supporter. I know that you've been supporting a lot, and it looks like we got around to your question even without a super chat. So I thank you very much for the question once again, and continuously supporting this channel and being here every night. I love that a lot of people find the content good enough that they watch it night after night. And so that being said, we're going to move on to the next question.
The next question is from Marina Samoilovich. They say, I understand that this chat is a pep talk for Ukraine, but how is Russia advancing?
Russia really isn't advancing. They've practically stalled along most of the front, and they're being pushed back in other places. So it is a prep talk for Ukraine because we support Ukraine, and then also the facts show that Ukraine is pretty much winning at this point. The war is turning in their favor as of the moment. That may change in the future, but right now that is the case. So thank you very much for the question. The answer is the Russians haven't advanced anywhere as of late. And so with that being said, we're going to move on to the final question.
And the final question of the night is from Lorraine Sweet. They ask, how many Russian soldiers in Ukraine are joining with the Ukraine army?
We don't actually have a number on that, and I feel like if that was a thing that was happening and something that the Ukrainians were allowing, that would be heavily publicized to show that Russians are so against what's happening here that Russian soldiers are actually joining our side after they surrender. So I don't really think any of them are, and if they are, they're apparently being kept secret to protect their identity, maybe so that way the Russians don't try and come after them once the war's over. But we don't actually have a figure on that, and that's actually been a repeat question here. A lot of people have asked about that, and unfortunately, we just have no information to really say anything about it. So I'm sorry about that. But if we get any information about it, I'm going to make sure to let everyone know as soon as possible. That being said, we've actually reached the end of the stream and the end of the Day 23 news. I thank you all so much for watching. We have a whole load of return viewers, and we have a whole lot of new viewers. And to my new viewers, if you enjoyed the news, a lot of people do, and I'm very glad that a lot of y'all find the content really well. Make sure to subscribe and hit the ring button so that you'll be notified when the stream comes on. It comes on every single day at 10 p.m. Eastern Time, and we cover the last 24 hours of events in the war. We always try and answer some questions from the chat that were not super chats. But one thing that super chats do help us to do is actually create a limited question pool that's very easy for us to manage. And also it helps us support the channel because we actually make no income rather than the income off of Super Chats. And so the viewers are kind of helping us make sure that this program keeps running. And so I thank you all so much once again for all of your support, both through just vocally and monetarily. It helps us run this channel, and it helps us know that we are helping out someone somewhere and at least delivering something valuable to all of y'all. So I thank y'all all so much once again, and I'll see y'all once again tomorrow at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thank you all once again, and good night.